Hey everybody, before we get started, just want to let you know that we are accepting submissions for the narrative portion of our podcast. In fact, we will always be accepting submissions. This podcast was made as a way to get people's stories out there. If you have an original short story and want to get it out there at full credit, send it to storytellercast@gmail.com. Once again, that is storytellercast@gmail.com. Cast with an S at the end. 1 cent, one of us will read it, or if you hate our voices and think you can do better, which honestly you probably could, send in your own voice recording of the story. For details, email us at storytellercast@gmail.com. Once again, that's storytellercast@gmail.com.
Besides, who let you onto the property, sir, what is your show's a position on bug fucking? And I say, you better listen to the next episode. We're gonna have a hot take on that.
On what fucking?
Bug fucking? Just
bug fucking. Bug fucking.
Oh, like a group? Are we talking about a group situation?
Well, the bugs are always in swarms. Like,
sure.
Does the swarm form like
one functional
as a whole?
Functional.
Do
we count arachnids too? There's an arachnid fetish, so I was wondering.
Is that a thing?
Yeah, spider fetish.
Are you talking about like monster girls or like monster people?
That's true.
Or are we talking about like
anthropomorphic?
I smeared peanut butter all over my balls and put it in a hole I found so spiders would come.
Yeah.
I just ground up a potato and rubbed it on my dick so that crickets.
Sure.
And potato bugs. Oh.
Super starchy. That's what they're about.
Yeah.
You have to shave beforehand, otherwise, like,
it
clogs up.
It.
And, like, it all clumps together.
It's so upsetting. It's so upsetting.
You're going to need more than water to get that off.
No, you're right.
Because it's starch.
I don't remember where I was reading. I had heard somewhere that that's, like, a problem for our soldiers overseas. This is maybe weird and gross and tangential, but you can cut it out if you don't like it.
Our audience has come to expect all 20 of them.
When we have soldiers overseas and we set up like the little base camps in Iraq and Afghanistan, we have like just so many. The only kind of private place for the soldiers is the shower, and they jerk off so much that the cum gets hard inside the pipes and causes horrible backups.
I can imagine, especially in like such a stressful environment.
Maybe
they should just have, like a makeshift jerk off shack.
Sure, a jack shack. Sure, hey guys, I'll be right back for the next hand of cards.
Well, see, now that we have the language to
once you put it into language.
Yeah. Now that we have come so far in society,
we've normalized
that jerk shack is a viable building.
It's good for it's good for unit cohesion.
It's all about de-stressing.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like you go through boot camp just to clean some pipes, like
You need a gender-neutral jerk shack, too.
Yeah.
It has to be for everyone.
It's not just for jerking, it's for jilling.
It's for jilling.
It's for
going to town.
Maybe they could call the shack the town.
The town.
I'm going to town.
There you go. Yeah.
It's like when you have to use a restroom and someone, like, the only restroom's occupied. And what if someone, like, we get so desperate to start fucking the sand spiders? Have you seen that shit?
I've seen sand spiders.
The sand spiders.
Sand spiders.
Maybe.
They're like these huge, like, they've got, like, crab pincers on the front of them. Yes.
No, I haven't seen it.
No, they're terrifying sand spiders. They're like...
Yeah.
I know I'm not helping by just repeating the word sand spiders. They're, like, somewhere between a scorpion and, like, a tarantula. They're huge.
Okay.
Sand spiders.
So it's like a scorpion and a spider had sex
and made a nightmare baby.
The nightmare baby had sex with...
But the nightmare baby can reproduce at all.
Yes. Yeah.
It's a self-sustaining economy.
It's a really self-sustaining economy, exactly.
Probably gets drowned in the pipes.
Jesus Christ. I mean...
No, you can't because it's clogged up.
It's their own... That's their
buried
own,
alive.
That's their only food source. There's not a lot of...
Yeah. It's not in that harsh environment. You need the seed of life.
It's really... It's the seed of life.
Yeah.
Jesus.
You gotta support the troops.
Then the sand spiders are like, I gotta go to town. I'm hungry.
Yeah. That's what I call my jism, the seed of life.
They see the seed of life?
Yeah.
Is that like you're hoping to have a Matt Damon situation, the tree of life? Like,
maybe.
One day. Maybe one
I
day.
I mean, I don't know.
It's not
something I'm holding on to.
Sure.
It's just...
Are you hoping for something more linear? Not...
like, I just... I don't know. Maybe something more fruitful. Something I could see in my lifetime.
Sure.
Maybe like a flower.
Do you remember...
Or like a rose bush.
Do you remember there was that Skittles ad that got really popular online like a few Super Bowls ago about the guy who comes Skittles? What the fuck is that?
The fuck? I don't know what that is.
That's so fucking weird.
More than the females, like the female mosquitoes are the ones that bite.
Oh, yeah, I have heard that. Like, the males are, like, really big.
So it's working. That was weird. Okay. If it sounds like there was a breaking conversation there.
That's because there was.
Because there was. I don't fucking know what was happening. The shit was just playing. So. Yeah, spiders.
Spiders.
Fucking mosquitoes, yeah.
Yeah, man.
I mean, Chris, what do you think? Like, is there a reason for mosquitoes to exist?
I don't know.
Alright,
sorry.
I'm gonna chew on that.
Man. I don't know enough. I'm not an entomologist. I don't. Welcome to episode. Oh fuck! It's like seven. Like six or seven. I think it was seven. Yeah. Last time I got it totally right while thinking I was wrong. So
okay.
That was cool.
This is a neat inversion of it.
Yeah, it really is. So I want to say it's seven.
You're probably right, and you just doubt yourself.
Yeah. So I'll just stick with seven.
Yeah.
I'd rather be rightfully wrong.
Yeah.
Than wrongfully right. So. Yeah. Welcome to this. Oh, this is going off on a rollicking good start. Oh. How is everybody? Feeling good?
I'm pretty good at the moment, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, full of vinegar. Full of vinegar, man.
Near.
Yeah.
I mean, Nick knows. I've been spending the whole day playing Nier Automata, so like, my head's in a totally different headspace.
Sure, sure.
Staring at the screen.
Please, do you wanna talk about
it? I mean, we can get to that when we get to our
what
we've been up to.
Okay,
you can come to mine last if we want.
Sure, sure.
What?
No,
oh,
I
thought you were gonna.
No, I wasn't gonna say anything.
You raised your hand and like you're okay. I thought you were gonna.
No,
say
I was something. Agreeing with you.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, like
what a good time. What a good time.
Yeah, no, I was just agreeing that, yeah, no, it'll be good to talk about Nier later.
It's
a lot to unpack. Like,
I'm not going to, here's the thing. Here's the thing about Nier is that I'm not going to say a lot. I'm just going to say basic mechanics or maybe what the starting, or what our experience was trying to get it running.
Yeah. Okay.
Because a lot of stuff in there is just spoilers,
right.
As with any... Like, okay, so there's this thing with the Nier community, specifically with the first one. They are very good at just not telling you what happens in that game. They are very good at keeping it tight-lipped, not spoiling anything. And they are awesome for that. Because that game, if you just go in raw, play it, maybe even watch a Let's Play, rewards you for just paying attention. And that game's amazing. The writing's amazing. The original Nier is what I'm talking about. The gameplay sucks. It's functional, but it sucks. It's the weakest part of the game. Everything else is fucking 10 on 10. Like, the writing, I think, is 10 on 10. The music is 10 on 10. I think the environment looks great. The side missions are eh. Like, it's a bunch of fetch quests. But the writing for those side missions are great. Kind of stuff you have to do to get those endings is weird, too. So, yeah, we'll get to my whole Nier Automata thing later. So let's see. Let's start with Ian.
Okay.
What have you been up to, sir?
What have I been up to? Let's see.
And there's another thing with, like, Nier, right? Like, everything's...
let me get this shit out, okay? I have a lot to say about...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. What's going on? I'm trying not to say much.
Gosh, what have I been doing? I want to save my reading for the stuff we've been looking over later. I've been doing a lot of reading.
Okay.
This is a lot of my time. The rest of my time has been working, and then I've actually been going out. I've been weirdly very social.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
How's that?
It's great. Working out for you. I hate seeing other people. It's very stressful, but I'm getting hammered in public places, which is a nice change for me. I subscribe to the old-timey writer tradition of sitting in a room and drinking and then writing and then crying.
Yeah.
And then sobering up and then editing, you know. Mm-hmm. That's the normal rhythm of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. But lately, yeah, I've had a handful of friends who are like, oh, we're going to go out to see this show. We're going to go out and do... So all my friends are effete Parisians.
we're gonna go watch this one man play.
We're gonna I've been going out and doing all kinds of stuff like that. It's really fun. Uh-huh. I don't know what else I can add about it other than there's, you know what, if you live in the Los Angeles area, and chances are you probably do if you listen to this.
Yeah.
There's a 90% chance that you are in the Los Angeles area?
Yeah, or in the Los Angeles area, or at least the Valley, or like...
Go down to Los Angeles, downtown LA, there's a whole bunch of wonderful little places... Wonderful little, dens of sin, and okay. you can do all kinds of things for not very much money. I'm being vague on purpose. Look it up yourself.
Yeah, there's an incredible amount of crack warehouses.
I'm not saying yes to crack. I'm also saying, you know, investigate the culture of LA. You know, just really get a taste for it. Really
Stop being a square. In your mind.
You know what? You're never gonna live life in your room for the rest of your life. Go out there.
I don't know. Not with that attitude.
Not
like,
with that.
I feel like I could. I've been doing it pretty well.
Yeah, go to a club, grab a pipe. Who knows?
Yeah. Who knows? You know what?
I'll walk to the bar, but like, I mean, it's not that far.
Maybe that one stranger who's talking to you with his head underneath the toilet stall you're in is your new best friend.
Maybe
that janitor who has had a dark past just by the scars on his face.
Yeah.
Maybe he's someone who can teach you about who you really are.
He was once a king.
He was once a king in a foreign nation.
Who fell to a coup?
His brother was a top surgeon who killed a Yakuza boss on purpose. I've been trying to go out and, mm-hmm. like I said, I've said it a few times, just going out and getting a feel for the LA area. I went to Frankenstein's for the first time.
Well, you never been there before?
Really? It's been a long time. It's been
maybe a year. So how's that?
I haven't been in a bit, but
I like it too.
I like it a lot. Forgive me because I'm terrible with names, but if you go...
I never remember their names. I never remember any
of the booths. There's a guy who's like fanny pack guy.
Yeah, you've told me about him before. I think I've seen him.
He's great.
Yeah.
He's still there?
He wasn't there when I was there, but his apprentice was there. His apprentice. He has like this young boy. That sounds suspicious. He has this guy. Have I talked about it on the show before? I honestly don't know. I'll talk about it again. Sure.
You keep doing that.
There's this little stall. So if you go into Frankenstein's through the left-hand, furthest left door, mm-hmm. which is like a big warehouse opening, and you go down the first alley all the way to the back, there's a guy with a big pole through the middle of his shop, mm-hmm. fanny pack, and he sells like collections of comics all in like... They're all floppies, but they're full collections at really good prices.
Oh, okay. That's pretty cool.
I would highly recommend that. I got... Hulk Gray, and I got Daredevil Yellow off of him.
Okay.
I got my first two collections of Sex Criminals off of him.
Okay.
I got some cool Neil Gaiman stuff, some really cool Gaiman stuff.
Yeah.
There's a lot of weird... He also has a lot of the DC Marvel crossover from the 90s.
Oh, okay, that time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Does he have the Punisher Batman one? Because I want to own a copy of that.
He might, because I know he has... He's displaying proudly a copy of Wolverine Batman.
I'm thinking of Wolverine Batman.
Oh, that's the...
Punisher and Batman crossover.
No, but that's the one he does have.
Okay.
It looks pretty sick if you want that.
Yeah.
He's selling it, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah,
I
yeah.
might go and buy it. Another problem with Frankincense is that a lot of the video game vendors are... ask way too much. Like, I think they ask a lot. And I remember if you ever talked to Matt about this, I don't know if we talked about it on the channel, but when last time I was with him, I was trying to buy Glover for the N64.
Yeah.
Because I would talk about it, and it would annoy the shit out of Matt, because I would go, this game's so fucking weird. Isn't it weird? Like, come on, we should do a playthrough of it. It's like, I don't fucking know anything about Glover. Shut up about Glover. I'm like, no, this game's weird. Let's do it.
It's a pretty great game, actually, yeah.
So I find it, and the guy's asking $15.
50?
Like, 15.
Oh, okay, 15.
And it doesn't sound that much, but I'm like, I know Glover is only worth 5 for the N64.
Yeah.
I'm like, fuck. Okay, I'll give you 10. I feel nice. And he's like, you wouldn't even talk down to 10. And really? he's like 12. And I'm like, no, fuck you, 5 then. What are you gonna... And then Matt's like watching this. He's like, dude, it's Glover. Who cares?
Yeah, it is.
And I'm like, no, he won't come down to my... I know I seem like the asshole in that story, but let me tell you.
Mm-hmm.
$15 is like,
I remember playing Glover. It's like a magic glove.
It's yeah. It's, it walks on 2 fingers. You have a ball. You can change the
density of the ball,
of the ball to shoot it across that stuff or hit stuff.
Yeah.
Got some weird bosses in there.
The music's weird. All the scenes are trippy.
It's fucking weird.
Yeah, it's just a really fucking weird game. We have it for PS1, really? That's cool, but yeah.
It's not cool.
It's
a bad emulator.
It's the worst version of the game.
A lot of PS1 emulated games are pretty bad.
Oh, no, really? We have it on disc, though, don't we?
Yeah, we have it. They're on disc.
Yeah, 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 but the PS1 version is the worst version.
Okay.
If I remember correctly.
Isn't Glover also made by the people who did Bomberman?
It could be. Hudson's off? Maybe. I don't know. I don't know.
It came from that same generation of games I remember having.
Yeah, Bomberman 64, I know it came around the same time. Yeah. Hudson Soft made that. Mm-hmm. I don't know if they made Glover. I thought Glover was some weird developer.
It's one Dutch man who did it by himself.
Man, have you seen Bomberman R? You seen that shit?
Have you?
Yeah, isn't that's the female Bomberman?
No, Bomberman R is not the female Bomberman.
Oh, that's not the female...
No, it is the Switch... Bomberman R is the Switch one.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
Bomberman R is the one people are saying it's pretty good.
Oh, really? Oh,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Which one am I thinking of?
You're thinking about Bomberman Girl.
Oh, there we go.
Or no, Bomber Girl.
Bomber Girl.
That's such a... Yeah, yeah, it would have been better if they'd call him Bomberman Girl.
So Bomberman... Bomber Girl is a Japan-only arcade game.
Yeah, yeah, there we go.
Where it is Bomberman gameplay, except they're all... You choose, like, 4 just really sexualized...
Mm-hmm.
Females where some of their body proportions don't make sense.
Jessica Rabbit styly?
Yeah, no, I'm talking... Nah, not that bad.
Okay.
Because at least they have consistency.
Okay.
With Jessica Rabbit.
Right.
It looks like a lot of the images they would show are to promote it.
Yeah.
Would just, like, their back should be broken.
Oh, yeah.
At certain angles, or why is it so long? Like, when you really think about it, why is their back so long?
Right.
Everything? Yeah. Aren't they just falling over?
These women are part mink.
Yeah, but only one of them, I'm like, okay, at least that body could work.
Biologically, possibly.
Yeah, yeah,
it's like sometimes you gotta think, ow, that must hurt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a painful existence. So that's Bomber Girl.
I just liked, when you said that, I just imagined, like, a doctor flipping through, like a chart.
Uh-huh.
Like, and how did these powers manifest in her? She was bitten by a radioactive Bomberman, and now she has Bomberman powers.
Bomberman just came in with rabies and started fighting people.
You're now Bomberman Girl!
Bomberman Girl. That's what they should have called Batgirl. It should have been Batman Girl.
Batman Girl! Oh my god! That would be... I just don't like my favorite permutation of the origin story is bitten by a blah blah blah. Blah, blah, blah. It doesn't matter. Like being bitten by a thing will give you that the attributes of that.
When he was bitten by a radioactive Hulk.
He was in the Andes, where the Hulks grow wild.
Frankenstein's.
Yeah, it's a fantastic place. I if anybody hasn't been there, I highly recommend it.
Great. It's only open on Wednesdays and Saturdays. Mm-hmm. Weird times, so look it up.
It is weird times. I would recommend...
They're consistent, though.
So they are consistent. It's... On Saturdays, it's early in the morning, and Wednesdays, it's evening time.
Yeah.
I would recommend Wednesdays.
Yeah, Wednesdays are less time. Of course, not all stalls might be open on Wednesdays.
That's true. Not all the stalls are open consistently.
And, well, sorry, sadly, since it's, like, summer, it gets hot in there.
It gets
crazy. Because it's a warehouse.
There's, there's no vents, no air conditioning.
It's, like, poured...
No, they just open the garage doors and, like...
It's two garage doors. That's the only way it's in. Yeah.
And there's your ventilation.
It's... And the floor is concrete and the ceiling is filled with, like, fucking asbestos or some shit. Yeah. So, like, it is... It retains the temperature. Mm-hmm. I went there in the middle of, back when I was an avid collector.
Oh, yeah.
And I still had money. Because
it was before the collecting.
It was before the collecting. I went there in the middle.
Those pop figures.
I stopped. I did stop. Oh, you did? Well, for now. I saw they put out Twin Peaks once. So
Right. Yeah, that is the dead body.
Laura Palmer.
Laura Palmer's body.
Yeah, yeah.
You should call Corey when you buy them.
I will call Corey. I'll call Corey and I give me his number and I'll call him and be like, hey, just wanted to like update you on what's going on here. Suck a dick. I'm sorry. He's really nice. I don't want that.
Yeah.
Come across that way.
Fuck it. I'll say it now. I'll remind myself to announce it. I should be on their podcast after the Power Rangers movie comes out because they're supposed to do an episode on that. And they invited me, well, not to watch it with them, but to watch it and then, like, talk about it on there.
Oh, that's be.
And as someone who has, like, no real interest in the Power Rangers movie, that's going to be fun.
That will be fun.
Because.
Can I say, I would legitimately like to have him back on so I can talk about, I just rewatched the old Power Rangers movies from the movie from the 90s.
Oh, yeah.
With Ivan Ooze. It's such I really want to talk to someone who loves it because it makes me laugh every single time. Every
is that part the one with the Jeeps? Like, they get the Jeeps on the boat?
They get Jeeps on a boat. They get, like, there's, like, they don't really explain the Zords in the movie, and they just kind of show up in the last 10 minutes.
Yeah.
There's a lady who's an owl. Oh my god, like, there's a lot going on.
Yeah, I don't have VHS, so,
like, watch it. Oh my god. Like, all these people are fingering these jars of purple goo. Oh,
yeah, okay, yeah. Then I think it was the same one.
Oh, my God. I love it, and I want to talk to someone who cares a lot about it so I can see him, like, try and defend that.
That's so mean. We both want to go on and talk so we can pick a fight.
Talk shit. Their favorite thing. Hey, you know how you like this thing? Let me say.
I like it a lot, yeah. Like, you know how you're finding me on this podcast about a thing that's surrounding a thing you love?
Hey, what if I ruined it?
Yeah. What if I just brought down the mood?
I talked about all the problems I have. All these 90s actors in, like, rollerblades constantly trying to emote. Oh my god.
There's one trailer for a Power Rangers movie I can't stand.
What's that?
I don't know, it keeps showing up on YouTube. I have never watched the full thing.
Oh.
Because I just wait those 5 seconds and then I skip the ad and go straight to the video I want to watch. But in those 5 seconds, it automatically plays that music where it sounds like every generic... Yeah, that's my song. It sounds like every generic trailer song where someone's just going, yay! and people are building shit like, oh, look, guns. They're putting guns together. And then it begins with the line of, we are a bunch of misfits. And I go, okay, go fuck yourself. Because I don't...
Okay, this is
we're a bunch of misfits. Society doesn't fucking get us. But we're gonna save it anyway because we're bigger people.
I want to say one thing that I will say to him. is because there's a scene. So there's a scene in the Power Rangers movie.
Okay, yes.
I have to talk about it. I'm sorry.
Sure.
So they're fighting, like, lizard people or some shit. Mm-hmm. And with mild gymnastics. Yeah. And there's a scene where, oh no, things don't look so good for the Power Rangers. They're getting cornered against a brick wall. What do they call it? Transform?
Yeah.
In the suits, and they do the wow, swish sounds.
Yeah, those sounds.
Michael Bay shit.
The back of it, and then the suits come on, and they're doing the exact same things, but in a costume now.
Yeah.
And somehow now, oh, but now.
Now it's stronger. Now explosions come out.
Now when they punch a guy, he disintegrates into a wall. That happened in that movie. That's not even... You're a really nice guy. I'd love to see you again on the show.
I don't know,
But, yeah, man, I'd love to... I can't wait to hear you on their podcast. That's going to be great.
Yeah, we got to set a date for that.
Oh, my God, yes, please.
For those who don't remember, it's the Go Mango podcast. Go shit on Sentai stuff over there. And then you can tell us how that went.
Yeah.
Because I would like to know.
I would love to hear feedback from another group's podcast.
Basically cyberbullying.
Yeah. Basically calling someone out specifically. Yeah.
Man, I like it. I can't even defend some of that shit. Like, the movies and then... I mean, the Misfits thing, yeah, it was kind
of
off-putting.
We're a bunch of Misfits, Nick.
But in the show, they were in high school. Like,
but they were pretty popular kids.
It's like cool kids. All-chick who says it. Opinionated all-chick.
Uh-huh, sure.
She was probably
Does she have a streak of colored hair?
I don't know. I didn't get to see her face. Okay. It was just all...
It was all VO.
Putting together guns.
Wait, when did the Power Rangers get guns?
I don't know, man. This movie's going to be weird.
I remember the Power Rangers were just like friends with a giant floating head.
Oh man, this episode's gonna come out the day,
really,
of the premiere. Yeah, the 31st.
Hey everybody, if you're listening to this, why not go watch the Power Rangers movie?
Bryan Cranston is Zod.
No,
you didn't know that?
No,
it's like the big thing. Yeah.
Is that true? Genuinely,
that's the only big thing.
Oh my god.
Yeah, I don't recognize any of the other actors. Again, I haven't been paying attention, only know so much about... I only know that one line and a couple of gun assembling shots.
Let's make some guesses about what the new Power Rangers movies will be, what this new one will be out about today.
Okay, the white guy is going to be the Red Ranger.
Yes.
Because we have to have a white leader, man.
That's right.
I don't even know if there's, like, a black guy in it.
I think so. And they make... No, I saw the... Okay, I did see the trailer, and I think he makes a comment about the fact that he has to be the Black Ranger.
Oh, really? Okay, that's at least cool.
See, because you're self-aware, the story's...
That's right.
I want everyone to be super uncomfortable, too, when he's making that. Like, I want Bryan Cranston to be just like, the gods are weird.
Sorry, guys.
It's
they're from a different generation.
The rules are written a long time ago.
Also, the girl ranger has to be pink.
Yeah,
and
the blondes.
Red ranger has to be this hot-headed, like, jump into the fray.
With no sleeves. He never wears sleeves.
Ooh, yeah,
never.
No sleeves.
Never wears sleeves.
The opinionated alt-chick is going to be either the yellow ranger or the...
Because
the opinionated alt chick might be Asian as well.
Oh.
You know,
that they also make her the... Did you ever see, I think it was College Humor did a Power Rangers sketch about...
I might have.
Yeah, that's a while back.
And I saw all the Captain Planet ones, so maybe I saw the Power Ranger ones while I was in there.
But there was just one throwaway line that I loved, which was they're pointing that out.
Yeah.
That thing. And then they're like, you know, you're the Black Ranger, you're the yellow one, and the Jew is the green one. Wait, whoa, what? Why? Well, you know,
the money thing.
Okay, I'm gonna go now.
what other predictions?
Oh, what other predictions can we have for this movie?
I think one of them has to die.
It's
the death.
No, then they're gonna come back to life.
Yeah, they come back to life for some friendship.
They're gonna be the White Ranger that comes back in the second movie.
Yeah.
Oh, they're gonna do a Gandalf.
Maybe.
Do a Gandalf.
Yeah, and then he got the Mighty Morph robot. Looks like a fucking Michael Bay.
Oh, man.
And then I want Char to show up from, like, outer space.
Yeah.
And then tell them, hey, Zeon is now gonna invade.
Yeah, just Zoids start falling.
Yeah, and then we have orbital colonies.
That sounds great, actually.
Zoids come out from the ground. Thank you very much. They don't come from space.
I was hoping
Liger Zero.
I really hope you didn't correct it, because when I said it, I really hope you didn't correct me.
So. I may be the only one in this room who watched enough Zoids.
I don't.
No. It was a test. Quotations.
We just making sure you all knew.
Yeah.
I also kind of hope that they have the fat and skinny bullies from who were like kind of in with the scary lady with the I don't know anyone's
name. So we want the American version of Power Rangers.
Oh, I'm talking about the American version.
We want it's called Angel City, isn't it?
It's called Angel City,
or something. Yeah, so we could have the bullies. One's really fat guy, the other is just a scrawny little guy.
And they both have bandanas on, so you know they're bad.
This is 90s, man.
This is the 90s.
Dude, and I want most of it to be in the high school.
Oh my god, yes.
Yeah, and then...
That high school looks amazing. Like, it's an amazing
Why are all these high schools, like, they look like they're well-funded?
Other than the obvious thing of they're not real and they're just cheating on like, I don't fucking know in these universes anymore. Like,
the education system just shit itself.
Biggest offender, I don't know if you guys remember the show, is Zoe 101.
I do.
That school is the biggest offender.
That's a lie.
Of the fuck you, no one gets into that.
No one's getting into that school. Like, also...
And then there's... sorry, go ahead.
Without, like, $1 million in tuition
child. And then there's like, episodes where they handle, like, some of the students have financial problems or, like, have to go through something. And I'm like, no, fuck you. If you're, like, in this thing,
If you're in a school that has, like... And it's an art school, wasn't it? Like, it was specifically an art school.
Might have been.
Again, not real.
Not real.
Yeah.
Not real that it's a middle to high school only for art students that has live-in dormitories.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And allows these children to be like, I'm going to start a marshmallow business. The fuck? Glasses, girl. I'm very bad with names.
I don't remember. I just remember that high school being the most egregious offender.
It was really terrible.
What about Halloween Town High? That's not real because.
Fuck it.
No. Pumpkins don't have access to schools like that, man. When's that going to be addressed?
True to me, damn it.
Now it's bullshit.
Oh, yeah, the skeleton has to be the taxi driver. Wake up, sheeple. I do remember watching all of those movies.
I watched all of them. I even watched the fucking shitty college one that like
where they replaced the girl.
Just becomes this like bitch fight between like the popular girl and like
it had nothing to do with like saving the magic world.
No,
or
honestly, the first one's like the only good one. I think the first one, series.
Yeah, the first one is an actual good movie, and the second one I still will watch because it has more shenanigans on a bus.
But yeah, that's true.
I do love bus shenanigans. They're my fourth favorite.
Halloween Town College, Halloloween Town U or whatever.
It was something like that.
Yeah, it's just sucks.
Because the third one also, now that you mention it, actually, because like the first two are like epic magical battles for like the souls of the citizens, and then three and four are like this is a municipal battle for resources in the town. You're going to have to bring an argument between town council, but only between 3 and 5. God help you if you come later than that. You'll have to leave a proposal under the door slip and reschedule. Then it just becomes like goblins and witches doing
the
most.
We get the crossover between Luck of the Irish, where the kid shows up. And, what other live-action Disney movies can be? Disney Channel.
The Other Me? Do you remember that one? Yeah. Where...
Get Tom Green in this universe, though, because Bob the Butler exists.
That's
true.
Work. Yeah.
This is true. The
the Disney Channel universe, the crossover. They all exist in the
Channel multiverse.
Multiverse.
Oh, my God. What was the other?
You can get the jump rope movies.
Because, like, Zack and Cody, and that's a Raven. Raven went into the hotel.
Isn't it like Johnny Kahuna, who is the surfing guy? But then he was like, nah, fuck that. I'm going to go into mountain boarding.
That's right, Johnny Tsunami.
Johnny Tsunami.
Johnny Tsunami.
It's really embarrassing that I remember. It's
the Disney multiverse.
How do we get to it? Oh, we were talking about the Power Rangers. I was bringing Gundam and
Can I say, do you remember, there was one Disney movie that I genuinely really liked, and it had Robert Englund in it. Which one? It was called The Paper Brigade, and it was like about...
I don't remember.
It was like a kid from LA moves to a small town.
Okay.
That plays in because everyone calls him Hollywood. Oh! So you know, yeah.
Is he like blonde and like...
He's got like one of those 90s like shaggy haircuts down past his chin.
Yeah.
And like he always wears a hoodie and rollerblades everywhere. So you know he's cool. He's cool. He's
different.
Guys. Different. He doesn't get... These kids just don't get him, you know?
Get it yet.
He's... And then he has to get a paper route to pay for I don't care what.
Yeah.
And, but basically, like, there's this crazy old man who has not paid for his paper subscription.
Okay.
Yet his boss still makes him, like, we'll just fucking cut off his papers.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
But his boss keeps making him, and this old man kind of implies that he wants to capture him with, like, Wile E. Coyote, like leg traps and shit.
Okay.
Never, and then, like, the twist at the end is, he's a veteran. He just can't let the war... It was a hard turn at the end. That was Robert Englund playing a crazy old man who's just, like...
He's suffering from, like, PTSD.
Severe dementia.
Yeah.
And then he wins the rollerblading competition with the help of a crazy old man. Oh my god, it's so fun! It's so fun! It's...
You gotta help but wonder where does that connect in the multiverse.
Well, I mean, I would not be surprised if Robert Englund's character,
if he hires help, who comes in the form of Tom Green. Butler.
He needs a butler to take care of him.
And then Bob, like, opens up the floodgates because the whole, like, one of the running jokes in that movie is that he knows everyone because he's worked for everyone.
Yes.
So he can cross over Halloween Town High.
He was a janitor maybe at the Halloween Town High.
Yeah, maybe at Halloween Town. Maybe he works at that bus stop. And like...
He works at the bus stop?
Yeah.
Oh, this is my bus stop. I've been bussing stops for years.
What a twist. Tom Green is the skeleton taxi driver.
Oh my god, that would be amazing. And then he's also a leprechaun.
He's also a leprechaun. He shows up in Look at the Irish.
Oh my god. Yeah. Oh my god, yes.
And then the guy from Look at the Irish is so good at basketball that he's like, nah, fuck it. I'm going to take up mountain boarding.
Oh!
Tsunami comes in.
Oh my god. I think this is the comic book series everyone's waiting for.
All the warriors.
But I want it to be established that if that were a thing, that it never stops being the 90s. It's always like...
That weird early 2000s, late 90s stuff, yeah.
Oh yeah, Xenon. Sorry, literally...
What's the one where they do jump rope?
Was that The Color of Friendship? Was that what that one was called?
Might be
called
that's the guy from High School Musical. He like did his own jump rope.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What, you mean Zac Efron was in that
film? Corbin Blue. Because he used to be... I remember that name because he used to be in this show in Discovery Kids.
Oh, okay.
Called, like, Flight 458 or something.
Oh, it was about kids who crashed in the jungle.
Yeah, it was, like, Lost, but better, and, like, had a cohesive story.
It had a cohesive narrative.
Because it finished.
The only weird part is they had these weird side things where they would go to a camera and then, like... talk about what's going on.
Really?
Yeah, like, and I don't remember if they introduced what the camera was.
Yeah. Do you remember? So
I had to assume it was like a log or something, but whatever.
Yeah, like the camera survived the crash, and they're all keeping it dark. Do you remember this other show on Discovery Kids? Forgive me.
Okay.
It was hosted by Michelle Trachtenberg off of Buffy's younger sister.
Okay.
It was called... Oh, shit. Factor... Fright or something like that?
I think so, yeah. Oh, they would like... And they is it as scary? Is it like a... What did they debunk like scary videos? Like,
it was almost like... The, it was
is
like
a real supernatural occurrence?
And they would interview like professional folklorists and stuff. And like, the vampire narrative probably came out of Romania and that blah, 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 blah. And it's
I think so.
Michelle Trachtenberg is like laying on a couch somewhere in a spooky house like speaking monotonely into a camera. Yeah. Ghosts. People who believed in
them. Yeah, I think so. Yeah,
yeah, I remember that.
Oh my god!
What was that one high school where, like, all the magic stuff happens? They had the it's like a boarding school, and I only remember the episode where one of the characters like grabs onto another character's shoulder, and then his hand gets stuck on her, and everyone thinks like
Black Holesy High.
Oh my god! Yeah.
I remember that show. Yeah. Oh my gosh! Yeah, well, remember.
And the hand gets stuck, and then like, oh, are they together? Because like, they had their hands stuck to each other.
And that premise was like, it's always like super science taken to an extreme was the premise.
It's the creepy dad who funded all of it.
The scary Anton LaVey dad.
Yeah.
And I don't think they ever solved, like...
No, they
got canceled. Yeah, it got canceled. The whole channel got canceled.
Can I say one thing that always bothered me? Because I was a big fan of that show. I love that show. Same. There's an episode where they go to a... Where Josie, the redheaded protagonist, goes to a parallel dimension, basically. And she finds out it's one where the evil scientist dad has just killed everyone.
Okay.
That's literally, like, the beginning is a nuclear holocaust has occurred, almost everyone's dead, and the only one who survived is the evil science dad and a parallel universe version of her.
Okay.
And she's just like, you have to stop him before all of this happens, blah, blah, blah. She's like, what can I do for you? Two of us can't exist in one world. And then her twin tries to murder her.
Oh, yeah.
And then she escapes. But also, like, oh, there's a parallel universe version of her that's going to starve to death in a nuclear holocaust. Yeah.
But then it's also like, when she tells her, do you have to stop him? But I'm going to kill you.
But I'm also going to murder you. Going to murder me.
Yeah. I also remember King Tut.
Oh, yeah, there was a little cartoon about King Tut. Yeah. You're right.
I think so.
Yeah. I do remember that. I do remember that.
Yeah, I wanted to balance out, like...
Let's talk about one we love, and then this other one.
This other one, we're like, oh, yeah.
That also existed.
So Frankenstein's... Power Rangers movie. So what else have you been watching?
Oh, gosh. Oh, shit.
Read anything, watch anything?
Sure. I'll tell you about what I've been reading. Mostly a lot of first-person, like, historical documents.
Okay, well,
it is actually interesting. Interesting stuff.
Mm-hmm. Well, if it's first-person, then it's, like, a person's account of it. So that could be... That's already more interesting than historical document.
I'm reading about the folklore of New England and, like, the history of that. I've been looking at the history of fairies, and so, like, here's the fantastic thing. So I'm reading this book called, you can all buy it, it's, like, 50 pages long, it's a tiny, tiny book, called Supernaturalism of New England, by Mr. Greenleaf, and John something Greenleaf, and it's, and he, like, basically outlines some of the major... kinds of myths that exist in New England. This is being written in 1840 something. And so he's talking about, like, you know, Americans, ghost stories, tales about the devil, tales about demons, tales about monsters and things like that. And he does one chapter about fairies. He talks at length about, like, he's talking about there's this Irishman who comes over to start a farm. And there were strange lights out on the fields. And he was like, oh, fairies are in my field. And so he tells all these people in New Hampshire, and he gets really good business for a year. And then the book says, but quickly the Americans tired of this. For in American's mind, fairy is one myth too far to believe in. We will believe happily in ghosts, demons, spirits, deals with the devil, but fairies... Tis folly.
It relates too much to the English. So,
like, it relates too much to the English. We hate them. and like his only explanation to why Americans don't believe is, like, he says we're too morbid. Our mythology is all too morbid to believe in beautiful glowy ladies. It's like, no, but if there was, like, someone suffering forever trapped in one place, I could see that.
Yeah, I could see that.
Our entire,
I can,
like,
see Jersey Devil. I can see
Jersey Devil is also in the book. Yeah, it's fantastic. But then
how's Bigfoot morbid?
Wait,
does he even talk about Bigfoot?
He doesn't talk about Bigfoot because that's more like a West Coast thing.
Okay,
and he's
The only the supernatural shit happens over there.
That's right.
You know that, I think
he's talking about everything
there's something called the Daywalkers that you watch, or whatever the fuck Wishbone. Alien beings walk in Central.
You have to stop bringing up 90 shows because I will talk about them all day. I will talk about Wishbone.
No, keep going.
There's only two videos out there. One of them's for sure fake, and the other, like, we're still not sure.
Yeah, we don't know.
Yeah,
we don't. Fuck. I want to talk about Wishbone.
There's the tall people who are just shadows we see on the hills that the Native Americans also called tall people.
The tall people. The hide behinds.
The hide behinds
of the Central Plains. They hide behind you, they hide vitrines.
But I think that actually pulls out from, like, I think some of the more Pacific Island, like, myths, because I know those exist.
Well, what over there? Which ones?
The Hive Mines? Yeah, the Hive Mines where you can, it's always behind you.
Yes.
Yeah, there's, I know for sure. Some okay. of those resort in like, at least I just found out like
really. Oh, okay. Soon. For sure.
So
for sure.
I wonder how it got like
all yeah, up there. Right? Well, I mean, there's also that thing about a lot of the Native Americans in like the New Mexico area. Mm-hmm. The I forget the tribe, but they're the ones who like carved their houses out of the cliff faces. You yeah. know those ones?
Yeah.
So like their language and mythology is actually like almost identical to Japanese Shintoism.
Yeah, 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 yeah. You know, I think I read a article on that.
And like nobody knows why. Nobody knows why though. Like yeah, there's yeah. no evidence that we have found of Japanese people having gone across the entire mm-hmm. ocean to change the like culture of people, but like yeah. how do you explain this? unless Shintoism magic. Is the true god. Oh, maybe man. Shintoism is the real religion and everyone else is wrong. Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
Yeah, man.
So it's a good book.
It's a great book. Yeah. I highly recommend it. It's a quick read. Mm-hmm. The other thing I have been reading was... Oh, no. Oh, it was about also about Native American myth, how it related to the people in New England.
Okay.
And about fairies. So I'm not giving away what I'm writing about. But, but how... Like basically,
how are you smelling fairies? Because that tells a lot.
With a Y.
Oh, boo!
Sorry,
boo!
You like IE? You
prefer? Yeah, I like the IE. They're more interesting.
They're more angry.
They're more angry. That's why yeah. I like them.
Fairy.
I don't want happiness and shit. I'm American. My you're morbid. To be morbid.
Fucking morbid.
That's how we like them.
Yeah. No, but like the Europeans who came to New England were mm-hmm. like really freaked out by that.
Yeah,
because they
because it's a big deal over there. It's a big deal in like their own mythos.
Yeah,
it goes exactly. all the way back to King Arthur and like everything.
It goes back, but then when the Europeans like met up with Native Americans mm-hmm. and the Native Americans are like, "Well, this is what we fucking do."
Yeah,
and the Native Americans talked about little people who lived in the fucking rocks and shit. That
yeah, like, oh god, what are they called? There's a...
Puckwidgie, I think, is one of them.
Yeah, I think so.
So, like, the whites get there, and they're just like, what the fuck? They believe in the same...
Oh. Jeez.
Should I stop?
No, go ahead. That was just the phone for anyone
okay.
wondering. I'm gonna... Like that.
So the Europeans get there.
It's going great today. I'm gonna keep that in.
Keep it in. Do it. I dare you.
Yeah, no,
do
I'll keep that in.
Commit.
I will.
And they were legitimately freaked out, and it kind of did spur some Europeans to start believing in fairies again mm-hmm. because they're like, oh shit, they think the same thing is real. That must mean it's real.
Yeah.
That must mean fucking fairies are real. If would they? Because they were like.
Are we crazy? Are we the only ones that see it?
Exactly. Because, like, Europeans made a point to not talk about that part of their culture because okay. most of them were Puritans. Yeah, so, yeah. like, they just want to talk about Jesus and angels and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So, like, the fact that they have mythology that mirrored European mythology really freaked them out.
Yeah.
Hard. So, mm-hmm. I'm very interested in that. Yeah, I think that's fascinating. So, go ahead and read on... John Greenleaf's body of works, The Poetry of New England and The Supernaturalism of New England. They're both, like, calling them books is generous. They're pamphlets.
Pamphlets? But, yeah, so I could probably read them, like,
Quick trip
or something.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, maybe I'll give it a
shot. Absolutely.
Cool. So watch anything, or like...
I watched Get Out.
Oh, awesome. We just watched Get Out.
We just did.
Wasn't it good?
Is it? Dude, it's really good. Really
should we not talk? Should we not spoil it? I mean, we can talk about it, not spoil it, or how do you want to do it? How do you want to talk about it? Because I refuse to ruin this for anybody.
I'll just say it was really intense.
I'm thinking about how to do this real quick.
Okay.
I really enjoyed it.
I do want to talk about it.
Okay.
Nailed it.
Tell you what, I'll give it, because it came out this month, right?
Yeah.
I'll give people a whole nother month.
Okay.
Don't watch it, and we're gonna dive right into it next month. Full spoilers, like now.
Okay.
Talking about racial tension.
Oh my
in America.
God.
Just the little nuances it gets.
Beautiful,
right?
Beautiful yeah. work in there.
And how it understands, and it's legitimately good horror, like in there.
Legitimately good horror. Great direction.
Yeah.
It visually is beautiful.
Oh, it's really good.
It
plays on little tropes.
It plays
that
on
that I find,
and it I think that it's really good at doing what a lot of horror from the 60s and 70s did more expertly, where it finds a problem in society and it just kind of digs its finger into
it. And it gets real specific. Those nuances. It's because it's not just racism, the movie.
Yeah.
It's a very specific thing in a very specific, like, mm-hmm. part of racial tension.
I think I can say this without spoiler, okay. And you can cut around if sure. it is. But I think a great thing about it is there aren't characters in this movie that are black hat racists. There's no Klan members. Mm-hmm. There's no, like, people in red hats. There's no people who are, like, I don't care for non-whites.
Yeah.
There's nobody who is like that. Mm-hmm. There's nobody who's like, the mixing of the races, nay!
Yeah. There's a very specific word I want to use, but I think as soon as I say it,
it would
give away much everything. So, well, it's a great movie. Go watch it. Really is worth it. People were telling me to go see it, and I finally did. It's really good.
It's really good.
I honestly can't wait to see what else Peele comes out with. Because he said he wants to do more social thriller movies.
Yeah.
At least this was
his phrasing.
Being categorized as.
Yeah.
So as long as he keeps choosing those very specific ones, I think he could work. Yeah.
And it is a movie worth seeing more than once, I think.
I think so.
Because when you watch whatever happens in the opening scene, mm-hmm. whatever that is, like, you kind of have a context to it.
Yeah.
But then now looking back, I'm like, oh my god, we're watching this, and this is who that is, and it all makes so much more meaning.
Well, there's one shot at the ending that clicks it all to be like, yeah, this exactly is who it was.
Yes.
In case you can't tell.
Yes.
But, so yeah, everyone go watch the movie. We'll talk about it next month.
Next month.
Really good. We'll just have to remind ourselves. Yeah, it was really good. I really dug it.
What a treasure.
What else do you want?
What else have I watched? I've been on... I don't know. You say something else while I think of what I've been watching. I can't.
Okay, yeah. Well, we'll move on to the next thing. What's been going on?
I think since the last podcast, between that, I've been rearranging the room, as you can see.
Well,
but listeners can just take my word that it's different.
Believe us,
it's different. So that was really interesting because, like, 20% was a friend was helping me move it around.
Yeah.
And within that 20% was actually the hardest part of it all, because then you just see, when you remove stuff, you see nearly a decade of dust and trash piling up.
Mm-hmm.
So that took the most time. Like, it took around 3 days, I believe. 3 days.
Oh.
To officially that.
Well, for everyone who can't see, because this is a audio medium, it looks very nice.
It looks very nice.
It looks very clean.
Yeah.
Everything's organized. The walls are very well utilized.
Golly.
But you know I'm a high-functioning autistic, and this is bothering me. I don't like changes to my routine.
You know, I thought about that when I did this.
How much of this irritated
me?
Remove this chair. This many inches.
The dimples are in this part of the carpet. Oh, you know what I have been... I'm sorry, man, but I just did...
It's okay, Nick was just a distraction. So
that's true, go ahead.
See,
I rewatched all of Harvey Birdman.
Oh, yeah?
Awesome. Because
I've been meaning to do that. I should do that.
It's such a good show.
Yeah. It's really clever. It's like... Scooby-Doo one and, like, the Speed Buggy one are still, like, some of my favorites.
No, because it's actually a good joint onto the back of Get Out in that I forgot how much social commentary was in the show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And as an adult now watching it, I'm like, oh, this is just about Bush. This is, like, 80% about George W. Bush. Like, there's a scene about espionage, like, someone's being... Oh, there's a guy who's being tried... Who had been sent to jail without a trial as an enemy combatant.
Okay.
And it was Morocco Mole. And he was being accused of being a terrorist. And so Harvey's trying him. And there's a scene where Stephen Colbert's character, Reducto, is talking to Harvey Birdman, and they're talking about, I mean, you don't think that the government isn't listening to you all the time, Harvey? They know everything you're doing, every single day. They're listening to all your phone calls in a secret facility under, and then they cut out to like a advertisement in the middle of him speaking. This advertisement brought to you by 7 and 7. Also, so you don't know that the secret listening facility is underneath a cornfield in Iowa. And then he like dials a number and he just says, "Watch, they're going to be listening to you after I say, terrorist attack, gas, Anison poisoning, same sex marriages." It's a really funny show. It's a very dense show. It's incredibly dense with jokes and references and jokes on jokes on jokes and jokes, which I think the only show that comes close to that level of writing density is maybe Arrested Development.
Oh, wow.
That's the highest compliment you can pay a writer, I think. And it also does a great thing wherein it does not give you context. It just starts doing the story and expects you to, like, infer what's happening, which I think... So you don't waste time with, like, needless talking. You can just get into jokes and story.
Yeah. The show's great.
The show is great. It's wonderful.
It really is.
And one other thing you should also watch, I was going to say, on Netflix, I've been watching a series called Abstract.
Okay.
Which is just a series of documentaries about artists and their artistic process.
Oh, that sounds cool.
It's very cool. It's very cool.
Part of the reason I watch Chef's Table is only.
It's kind of comparable to Chef's Table.
Yeah, I just finished watching it, too.
Oh, Chef's Table?
Yeah, it's awesome.
Oh, my God.
New season is really interesting.
Oh, there's a new season came out?
I think so. Well, I told you. Last... There's Chef's Table, France, and then... Wait, did a second season come out for the other one?
No, third season.
Oh, okay.
Third season, I just been watched all three seasons. Oh, it's awesome.
My God. I might be behind.
Talk about it later on.
It's okay. I'm, like, barely catching up on shit now, so...
Oh, my God. But, yeah, they interview... this photographer who worked for George Magazine, which was the magazine JFK Jr. started.
Yeah.
And he's like, his thing that he is well known for is he takes pictures of world leaders. Yeah. And that's shtick. And they film him doing a session with Colin Powell. And then they're like, oh, and here's my wall of presidents. It's Poppy Bush, Clinton, George W., Barack Obama. And he, like, talks about, I've done such and such, I've done this. And they're like, who was one of the hardest ones? And he's like, well, I did take Vladimir Putin's photograph. And that was pretty intense. He's like, what did you do? Because his thing is, like, he talks to the subject until they kind of open up enough that he gets a glimpse of their essence, is the phrase he uses. So that he can get, like, a raw, like, that's what this person is in one image.
Yeah.
And he's just like, we talked about the Beatles for a really long time because that's the only thing I knew he liked and then I could talk to him about.
Yeah.
It's like, what was it stressful? It's terrifying. He's a terrifying human being. He does not like talking. He does not like having conversations. I had half an hour to get the photograph. It's very stressful. Was he the worst one? I did also take Muammar Gaddafi's photograph. And he's murdered people. I know.
Wow.
He's great. I met the artist. I did. But yeah, you should watch it. It's really good. They also do ones about like interior design, architecture, art, all kinds of art. It's great. It's really great. And again, I think to what you might have said, I'm going to attribute it to you about art, about Chef's Table, is anybody who does something really, really well, you can learn something and apply it to your life. I think that is true. Did you say that?
I wish.
I felt like you said that.
You know, let's assume I did.
Let's say you did.
I did.
Sure.
Because I do. I do watch like other artists do something really well for like inspiration.
And you can take something out of it.
Yeah. Even if you know fucking nothing about what they're doing, you take something from their ideas, from their manifestos, as weird and culty as that sounds, as they're basically getting into their headspace and like seeing how they make things work.
Yeah.
Just concepts and stuff.
Cool. Yeah.
Cool. Any else, Nora?
Let's say no.
Okay. Cool. All right, Nick, back to your thing.
No, I think...
Are we going to keep talking about your room?
We can...
No, that's pretty much it. I mean, that's pretty much that for that filler story.
Sure, thanks.
Not much else to add.
Yeah.
And before that, a couple of days before, I finally built, for the first time, a PC.
Oh, from ground up?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great, man.
Chris bought parts.
Yeah, I helped buy some of the parts.
A friend of mine.
Just because I'm going to be using it for stuff.
This guy? Yeah, yeah.
This guy back here?
Yeah.
One
back
there. There's one on the table behind.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
One behind Chris, yeah.
It's really strong.
It's very nice.
It's very fast. Anyway, so it's interesting because it started like...
Editing is going to be so much easier. It's going to be great.
It started... yeah, no, it's going to be cool. It's interesting because it actually all started nearly a year ago.
Yeah.
When my friend, I talked to Hal before, on the, like, I think it was the first two episodes, how I go to a lot of thrift stores with a friend.
Yeah.
So within that time period, he bought the case for like nearly very, like a dollar.
Oh, around, okay. Around
that, like dollar. Like he literally threw cents. Like it was that low.
Oh, wow.
And he bought a PC case and he looked at me as we left the store and he said, well, you know, Nick, I want to sell it for more because clearly it's worth more.
Yeah.
However, if you do buy a piece at one point, I'll give it to you and then we'll start working on it. Look for pieces.
Oh, okay.
And eventually I did, like a few months after. And then it eventually circulated to just adding on more and more parts. Mm-hmm. It was pretty crazy, like when you learn for the first time how to build it. Because like, the whole time I was sweating because I was so nervous that I was going to break something. That I was going to smash like hundreds, $200 worth stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, it all worked out really well.
And it looks like, so you've made this specifically for gaming or is it also for work?
I wanted to like have a balance for multiple things.
Okay, sure.
For gaming, recording, and, you know, home.
Yeah. Your basic browsing. Needs. Your basic.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But yeah, no, it was really fun. It was crazy because we started nearly at noon, and then we just finished like at 4 a.m. the next day.
Oh, wow. So you just burned through the night.
We did, yeah.
That's great, man. That's very cool.
Nice.
For those who can't see it, it is a perfect, beautiful cube. Obsidian black.
Yeah.
There's a series of blinking lights on the top. Not in any particular cohesive order.
Which I have shown, if you press in certain sequence, the cube opens up, unveiling a nice turquoise light that flashes through. And there you can see the interface.
That's right. The desktop seems to be covered in a series of Cyrillic lettering, mostly Roman, but possibly also Russian.
It's what people call the language of the gods. Is what goes on. And in there we have a small celestial being.
Sure.
Powering the thing on a little hamster wheel.
Too morbid to believe in such a thing. Sorry. that's fantastic. That's really cool.
It really is, man.
Yeah, and during the weekend of moving stuff around, my only break within the 3-day period of moving stuff around and the PC was watching Samurai Jack.
Okay.
First episode, 11 a.m. First episode, 30 minutes, that's all I had. So I had to make sure I had an alarm set and everything. Like I was holding some heavy shit and then the alarm went off and I had to drop it and then run downstairs to watch the season premiere of Samurai Jack.
Okay, so as of this episode, at least when we're recording it, by the time this episode airs, third episode should be out.
Yeah.
We have just seen the first two episodes. I assume have you seen both?
I have.
Okay.
Same.
So, let's not talk about plot details. Let's wait for that until the entire series is finished.
All right.
Then we can just fucking dive in and talk about the actual writing and everything. Right. We can talk about everything else, though, because the art is fucking amazing. So it's everything. Cool. Everything is a goddamn painting that can hang on, like, my fucking wall. Dude. Or, like, in some art gallery.
Yeah, belongs. Dude, what a way to start a season. Right. Holy it's shit.
Fucking awesome, dude.
What a way. What? God
it damn. Has my favorite character design in the entire series, and it's just a silhouette. And we don't know what it is.
Oh!
But it's, I fucking love that silhouette on green gas, like, so much. Yeah. That I fell really in love with it. I love that image. Right. I can't wait.
It's been a long time since I've been jumping out of my chair, like, watching live TV. Like, it's been so long, and it didn't really hit me until the first episode after it ended.
Yeah.
Where I was just like, when's the next episode? When's it coming? Like, I was so excited.
And it's a nice parallel to the first episode.
Yeah.
It does establishes a lot that is at least it establishes a lot of where Jack is at at the moment really well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's just fucking good. Still some of the best fight scenes in, like, any cartoon.
Yeah.
Like, still well choreographed and interesting. And the second episode has my favorite fight in like the entire series, just because of the lighting effects.
Oh, I think I know what you're.
Yeah, just God, they touch upon it in the first episode, and you go, "That's the coolest looking thing I've seen," especially because of how the lighting is dynamic. They're not just solid shades onto the characters; it's a breathing light.
Yeah,
and they do a whole fight scene in like the second episode of it, and it's the coolest looking thing ever.
Yeah. Gosh, I don't know what to say, but
it kind of reminded me of the episode where he faces the white ninja. No, the black ninja.
Oh, samurai.
Samurai, yeah.
Yeah, samurai.
Or that one.
Yeah. With the MC Hammer pants. Yeah.
Samurai. Well, he's Wesley Snipes.
He's Wesley.
Yeah. So. That one, and when he faces the ninja. Was it the other samurai wearing all the black, and it's all black and white?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Can I also say, like, so the first episode, whatever happens, tonally is great.
Yeah.
It's amazing how much they communicate. I mean, Jack was always great with very little verbal communication.
Yeah.
It's visual all the way.
Yeah.
The tone, though, I was amazed that, because it has gotten darker, a lot darker. Mm-hmm. But there is still funny parts.
Oh, yeah. There's still
moments
moments that are generally good. Get a good laugh out of it.
Yeah.
They're just allowed to take those darker, more moody, like, scenes and kind of turn it up a little.
Yeah.
And they do turn it up quite a bit in some aspects. But it's never too much to the point that the show becomes something else. It's still its own ordeal.
Yes, yeah. But
especially with the way the second episode starts.
Yeah, especially with all the things in that episode, man. But
I don't even want to say anything because I didn't think we were going to get to a certain aspect of it so early on.
Oh.
I thought a lot of it was going to be us building up to seeing what happened.
See, I think that the rest of... Now I think it's going to be the fallout, him dealing with the thing that happened.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's going to be great. No, I can't wait. I can't, like, this show's amazing.
If you saw it, you know what we're talking about.
Yeah. Samurai Jack's still quite possibly the best cartoon. Yeah. Artistically, like, from a writing standpoint.
Yeah.
And from just subtlety, like, ever aired.
And also, like, there's that scene, again, I will not spoil, but there's that scene where he's hiding and kind of having that interior moment. And he directly talks about, kind of addresses this exact thought process of, oh shit, I'm sorry.
Yeah, because it's going to be annoying to some people who do want us to dive right in.
Yeah.
But I do, for these kinds of talks, I prefer for television shows to watch the entire thing.
Yeah.
Or at least an entire season. That way we can really go into it.
And look back and forth and see what everything lines up.
Because by the time this thing airs, and a whole nother episode should have passed, maybe even two? I would have to double check. Sorry for not getting it. That show's amazing, though. Everyone go watch it. Give it views. Yeah. There's this thing where a lot of people are like, give it views so they make another season of it. It's not at all what I remember the directors and writers saying. They said this is it.
Right? I think this is the
end. They want to end it.
This is the end.
Because they don't want a chance of it
dragging out again.
Yeah. Which I am perfectly okay with. The older I've gotten, I've wanted closure.
Yeah. Closure's way more important.
I'd rather have closure. I'd rather have,
6 episodes and done.
Yeah. Then tell me the story.
10 incredible episodes and 26. Okay.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's that whole thing. Would you rather a show drag on that you really like, or would you rather it end abruptly?
Do you want Arrested Development, or do you want House?
Yeah. I'd rather have Arrested Development where I can look back on it fondly and go, hey, every episode was fucking great.
I liked season 1-4.
I like that leg scene.
Yeah, that was that's so much of that show. You remember that leg thing?
Yeah. But that was
that show was fantastic. It's like tremendous. Everyone go watch it.
Absolutely, visually untouchable. Like
there's so many things I want to say and ask you.
Yeah,
what you think about it?
We can talk about it after.
You can ask Chris later.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot that I do think. Yeah, that show's just fucking great.
Absolutely.
Again, as soon as that season ends, we'll probably do something and, like, talk about it.
Yeah.
Have you guys checked out what else Adult Swim is producing personally, like, as far as revival?
No. No, that's, dude, these past couple weeks have been incredibly busy for me.
Okay.
For sure. I'm only now being able to, like, watch stuff and, like, catch up.
So, to my understanding, it is Samurai Jack is the latest one. Mm-hmm. They're also, as we have said many times on the show, they're doing a two-season revival of FLCL.
Mm-hmm. And each season is going to be 6 episodes,
mm-hmm.
and they're all going to be their own little thing.
Yeah.
So
it's going to be like 2 more mini-series, basically, mm-hmm. that are in the same world.
Which sounds more interesting to me than them just doing
a continuation.
Yeah, continuation.
Yeah. Would I be curious to see what Nauta's doing? Maybe a little bit, just like a peek.
Well, we said it in the Fully Coolie commentary. Like, at least the way I want it is, we kind of, maybe he passes by, and we get a little hint
of what his life is like, or that he's like a character who passes through one scene, who's just like, oh, what? The bakery guy, yeah, or something like that.
Yeah, oh, maybe. No, I don't think his character would want to take over
the bakery. I doubt that he would want to do that. But I have no idea what Nauta as an adult would do. This is a totally different. Sorry.
You know what we should have done? We should have just done an entire episode where we.
What do we think?
Just made up fanfic. What do you think Fully Coolie should go from there?
Well, this is just fan fiction now, and I don't support that.
And Ian's fan fiction is just Nauta and Nina Mori.
Yeah.
Like, out on some traditional Japanese.
Vacation.
Like mountainside.
Yeah. She is a perfect white lotus blossom on a snowy hill.
Precious little salmon bun who cannot be spoiled by or judged by.
Still wearing the glasses.
And Nauta occasionally still has like weird shit fall out of his head now and again. It turns out you can't turn it off.
Oh, yeah, it's just weird. It's like it would have to be like a Space Dandy esque thing. Where it doesn't matter actually what's falling out of his head.
Yeah.
It's just the fact that stuff is falling.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But enough Fully Coolie fanfic. Nick, how else is here?
No, that's cool. Besides that, I binge watched and caught up to season 3 of Chef's Table.
Did you like that
show? Mm-hmm. Oh, it was phenomenal. I think
it was great.
It was my favorite season.
It's beautiful. It's beautifully shot.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. The second season was always my favorite because the story with Brazil is always fascinating.
The guy who cooks with fire?
The guy who brought back, who brought Brazilian cuisine and modernized it.
Mm-hmm.
They kind of have that again, however, but with Russia.
Oh.
The guy's bringing back old recipes that were lost during the revolution.
Oh, wow.
And bringing it to Russia because before, the modern chefs couldn't find them. They refused to use them. Because they didn't think people from outside of Russia would eat it.
Right.
Because it's not familiar. They're not used to it. But he's like, nah, fuck it. You guys are cowards. I'm going to fucking do this right now. And he does it. Like, one of them, it's like moose nose. You cut off, like, the nose of a moose and you skin it. And you serve it. But
so
he
fucking Russian.
And then you kill it.
That's like the most Russian thing ever.
And then you kill it.
Yeah. No.
Yeah, not even the entire moose. You have to
just the nose.
Yeah.
But I assume you have to cut it off mid-combat.
But if I were to pick one episode from season 3, I would recommend personally is the one of the monk.
Mm.
The monk in Korea who serves for free. She's a cook who serves for free. And it was funny because it actually starts off as a really high-end critic and who was recommended by a friend that he had the greatest meal ever up in the mountains. At this temple, you have to come with me, And this critic says, oh, I was so busy. I said, no. But a friend calls him again and says, no, but you really, really have to come.
Nah, man, come on.
He's like, he literally says, it changed my life. Like, it changed how I see things now. He's like, oh, okay, sure. And sure enough, when he went up there, it did. It changed his life.
Sure.
Because just, I think he basically talks about how the environment and how all the monks presented the food. And how it was served, and just the whole atmosphere, the whole vibe, and basically, pretty much, it was. It's a really interesting documentary, and you see the monk, the chef, her whole story of how she left her home as a teenager,
okay,
and went to the monks in spite of her parents, And then
yeah, fuck those people.
Yeah, which is a really it's a really
they could be nice.
People. Yeah, it's a really like it's really
no, but fuck them. They did like they didn't want her to. Okay,
mom, you don't understand. I just want to abandon a materialistic world. I don't.
I just want to do good for people.
Yeah, but no, that whole story is really really great. It's heart wrenching towards the end.
Sure,
but it's like the bittersweet kind, mm-hmm. and that's where it leaves
like
off.
Like life.
Like life.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and the kind. And to kind of go on the whole creative process Chris was talking about, what you can take away from it. One of the things the monk talked about.
What? What's that look? What's
nothing.
Ian just gave me this look.
I don't know what you mean.
Said, yeah, and then he's like, this guy's so full of himself.
It was because...
It was not me going, yeah, man, I said that. I'm an attentive listener. I have to signal it some way. Yeah, it's the way I do it.
Yeah, I'm pretty cool, right? I'm sorry, Chris. Nick, go ahead. Nick.
Sorry, I had to get that out of the way.
Will we ever get through this? I don't know.
Saw that
part. I think so intense with you, I swear, Chris. Anyway, no, basically she kind of talked about how like you have to let go of ego. It kind of limits creativity. Mm-hmm. And that's basically her whole approach. Was kind of like she actually goes down to Seoul, South Korea.
Oh, okay.
And basically goes to a lot of restaurants there as a teacher, and basically it's really interesting to kind of see how she explains her approach to people who live in the city, and a lot of people are really shocked and surprised by how she approaches it because you know how competitive the mentality is down there. So that's her takeaway. From cooking. It's really interesting. If I were to pick one just to watch from season 3, it would be that. And that actually might be my favorite episode out of all of them.
Oh.
All seasons.
Yeah, they're all really good. So.
Yeah. Other than that, I've been catching up on Fire Emblem Conquest. The Fate series.
Playing
the Conquest.
I've also been playing that game.
Yeah, so Fire Emblem.
What do you think? I think, because I've told you a lot about my complaints. What do you think of the game?
Okay, so I haven't played Birthright, so I don't know the approach it takes.
Yeah, it could be different. I haven't even finished it, for all I know, it changes. But.
Yeah, I picked Conquest. There's two games for the same story. There's Birthright and Conquest. Birthright is the supposedly good guys who rebel against the big scary kingdom. Mm-hmm. And Conquest, which is what I'm playing, your main character is someone who was born of the Birthright side, the rebellion. Kidnapped into the kingdom, raised as a princess or prince, and then you're trying
depending on what character you
choose. Yeah, depending, because you pick genders in the custom character. And you're trying to overthrow the king on the inside.
Okay.
So, that approach, I picked it in particular because I heard it's more strategic, therefore it's harder.
It's harder. It's definitely harder.
Yeah, so
you have less resources, too.
Agree. Yeah, that's the first thing I noticed.
Well, because I was reading up on it too, I wanted to know what some of the early game differences were.
Yeah, that's the first thing I noticed. I don't feel I'm too deep into it to give a genuine complaint.
Mm-hmm.
I guess one thing that I'm kind of concerned about is maybe about kind of the resources themselves, what you are given.
Mm-hmm.
It feels a little strange and out of place when you do receive them. Because you always think about how they connect to the world.
Yeah.
So some of the resources to me, at least...
Oh, there's a word for that. There's like a... Yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about. Yeah.
It seems,
go ahead, anyway.
It seems more I'm getting them out of convenience than out of the story. So right. It feels out of place in it. I don't know. It kind of kills the like immersion a little to me. I'm not really sure how to put it. I think the story itself, it's pretty good.
Is it like that Fallout 3 thing, because this is the example I was giving when I heard that word for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I really wish I remember what it was. Mm-hmm. I know it starts with a C. Mm-hmm. But it's that Fallout 3 thing where there's this like town in Fallout 3 underground that was destroyed by like a nuclear like explosion, I think, or a factory or something. And they're all horribly radiated mutants. And this happened, they've been living like this for hundreds of years. And then one of the missions they give you is, hey, we ran out of food. Can you get it from this supermarket that's 2 miles away that we've been regularly getting food at for over 100 years? Mm. And immediately you go, what? And then you go to the supermarket, which again, this has been feeding an entire town for 200 years, and it's a big town. And it's still, like, stacked with food and everything that survived. Yes, radiation and stuff for 200 years, like, over 100 years again. Mm-hmm. It's one of those things where, in the world, it doesn't fucking make sense. Why would... Yeah. And that's immersion breaking. And that's kind of, like, the thing you're yeah. at least I'm getting from you.
That's, like, why there's still food in Beauty and the Beast's castle. Like,
yeah.
Who's stocking that who's place with food?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's 10 years, right? Yeah. 10 years, it's someone 10 has years. To be stocking that place yeah. of food.
I
that kid was 12 when he was, like, turned by an old woman. Okay? Like, fuck off. Fuck off that old lady's this petty asshole that, like... You kid's have, 11!
You have till you're 21 to find someone who loves you.
Who loves you to learn to be a good person.
And who you
fucking
love
fucking 11-year-old whose balls probably haven't even dropped at that point. Yeah. The concept of love probably didn't even mean anything to me.
Prince, why are you answering your own door?
You're the prince. What's up with that? Yeah. What's up with that? Like, how was she able to get to the front door? How is she... This castle should have a moat and, like...
Can I also say, I have not seen the new movie, which
either.
Just came out, but apparently the new movie does address a part of that.
Okay.
Which is that the Enchantress, mm-hmm. her spell also affected all the people in the country.
Okay.
Or village or whatever.
Okay.
It's not clear. But basically everyone forgets that there is a castle or how to get to it or that anybody lived there. And so, like, the baker in the village,
uh-huh.
his wife was the maid, Mrs. Potts, and he forgets he has a wife and a child.
Huh.
Which is a whole other level of, like, sad.
Yeah.
Actually.
Wow. I'd rather know his story.
Yeah, I want to know his story, yeah. where he's been living 10 years without his, like...
That makes, what, so is Chip around? Wouldn't that make Chip...
He should be, like...
The son?
I guess, like... But, see, it's not clear...
Did she have the kid?
Did he fuck as his teapot?
Yeah.
Did he put his dick full of mosquitoes inside of a teapot?
Well, it could be if we're fucking around memories now, we could just use the excuse that Chip was just some rando
kid
that she took up.
But also, it's possible that when, like, Beast is the only one who's aging and all of his servants are immortal mm-hmm. objects.
Yeah.
Which, like, oh no, I'm... Eternal, how eternal terrible.
Well, it is terrible. But well, yeah. I don't think 10 years is enough for someone to fully...
Appreciate immortality.
Appreciate mm. it.
So if Chip is missing a piece of himself, is he physically or mentally disabled?
I think it's just a tooth, but yes, good point.
It's a big one.
Because that's like...
That's his head.
What part of... Yeah, what part of a cup is the mouth part?
Yeah. Well, in the cartoon, it's very obvious what's the...
Yeah.
I don't know what the fuck it is for live action. I haven't watched it.
I have not watched it, but this is a piece of information I was given.
Are you going to watch it? Because there's too many movies out that I want to watch, and that was not really up there for me.
No, I'm not going to watch it.
No.
I might watch Aladdin when they do Aladdin. If they're going to do Aladdin, I'll watch
it. They're doing Aladdin, I'll watch Aladdin, because they have to do Jasmine right.
They have to
do. And Jasmine's like one of the three good Disney princesses. In my...
Can I say one other thing about Aladdin though? If they do Aladdin, and when everyone's like, do it right, do it the right way, please don't actually cast 15-year-olds. No. I don't want to watch 15-year-olds.
I don't.
Do any of those things.
Mid-20s, maybe.
Yeah. Yeah, like 20-somethings, I'll watch 20-somethings.
Well, it's like, the obvious question is, how are they going to do Genie?
Oh no! Yeah. I didn't. Why would you make me think about that?
Okay,
Chris?
So back to
why,
my week.
Why was that not? How's that not the first thing that comes to your head? With...
All right, yeah, back to my week. So
yeah, your thing. I'm sorry, man. Okay. Go ahead.
No. Yeah, no. I think that's my whole thing with Fire Emblem. I mean, the story's pretty solid. I'm really liking. I think I'm more interested in the characters than just, if it makes sense. I'm more interested in the character interactions than the world itself.
Okay. Well, that's how it was for Awakening.
Yeah. Oh, is it? I haven't played.
Oh, okay, yeah, the character interactions were way more interesting.
Yeah, I think I was more
so invested. You haven't played Awakening. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that makes my problem unique from yours.
Oh, okay, yeah, so I don't have anything to compare it to, because the last Fire Emblem I played was the second game ever.
Okay.
Way back, so this is like a huge learning curve. Yeah. But I do like the character interactions. The support, like how you, when you level up the social...
Oh, yeah, so yeah, you were starting to see my problem. Yeah. With relationships and how they work in the game.
It's...
Like, how are they friends after that? How are they... How are you... Or my favorite ones are when you get to that high one, to A rank, and you can move them up to S so they can start making some babies and pumping and helping out the war effort.
Is when you start.
How does it jump? Thank you. From A to. From, hey, we now fully understand each other, to let's fucking make a baby and support this war effort. For Ian, who doesn't know the best part of Fire Emblem Awakening, and the new part of it is that you can you basically have a breeding simulator where you can have where once they build up their relationships, you can see, hey, now they can get married and they'll have a kid, and because of time shenanigans, you can have that kid now fight in the army for you as a fully grown adult.
I don't know why people think that people who play video games don't know how sex works. I don't know why they assume that. I don't know.
In Awakening, what it is, it's a much better excuse than I'll say fucking the new ones.
Awakening, indeed.
Is there's an actual, like, wizard or warlock who is coming back in time to actually fuck up the timeline so it actually comes into his image.
Sure.
Yeah. So that whole cliche thing. But what also happens is that when you find out one of the kids, Lucina, as everyone knows, comes back to fix that problem. She's basically a time cop. So the way it works is if a couple gets married now, they don't even have to have a kid at the time. They'll just know in the future.
There will be a baby.
There will be a kid, because that kid is part of the army.
Jesus Christ.
In the future. Yeah. And travels back in time. In this game. Because at least they thought it out somewhat. And it still makes sense. Because you don't even have to have the baby right now.
Yeah.
In the middle of war.
Mm-hmm.
To have the... Yeah. In this, no, you pump that baby out, and then you put them off into this realm where time travels, where time passes differently. And then they can just come in and out, visit their kids, or if they want to, hey, you can come join us and fight now, because you're like an adult.
Like that.
You know, like daycare? It's like a really long daycare.
It's like Pokemon daycare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Except they level up way faster.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's how that game works.
There's some conversations I had. I was telling Chris about this. They're just so out of place. Like, how can they become friends after this exchange of words?
Mm-hmm.
Where, okay, there's one character who's known, his personality, his whole shtick is he's an archer who's very sneaky. He's a very sneaky guy.
Sneaky,
like a fox, like,
sure.
Like trying to, like, he steals shit. He steals everyone's shit. He's known for stealing people's shit. So there's one character who is a princess or prince. Okay. No, she's a princess.
Okay.
Of the royal family.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And she has an interaction with the guy. And it's kind of a different, it's a polar opposites because, well, he's conniving and he insults everybody.
Okay.
And just for no reason. And the princess is very caring. She's a very caring person. So you see this opposite interaction. So the guy literally goes up and says, like, something along the lines of, oh, hey, how are you today? Your hair looks terrible. How can you fit? How can your fat ass fit in that armor? And she's like, What? I don't get it. I don't understand. Bye. And then he runs out.
Just be a piece of shit and block away.
And she's like, what?
I love this character.
What did I do? And then it says, support level C. Okay. Sure. I'll let them fuck. Let's just get it there.
You gotta pump the baby out for the war effort.
How did your fat ass pump this baby?
So, how did you and your wife meet? I called her a fat piece of shit. Then we banged.
And her hair was bad. Like,
yeah. I was like, okay.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, man. I hope there's more of those conversations.
So that's like my biggest problem. That's one of my biggest problems with the game now. Is just because I've had no one to fucking talk to about this.
Yeah.
As of late. I like the characters in Awakening way more.
Okay.
I do. Of course, I'm playing Birthright. I haven't played yours yet, and that's a totally different set. They're still good characters in Birthright, although they're all kind of shallow. They're all more anime tropey. Like, you literally have a guy who's just a fox guy, and he has fox ears and a big fluffy tail, and he can fuck any woman he wants in the village. Oh. Also, he's a real nice guy, playful, and, like, that's
loves
it.
Loves to yiff.
Oh, he loves to... No, I don't even think food is, like, his part of his personality. Oh. Because, you know, like, there's an anime thing where, okay, he's a big, strong character. Eating. Yeah, so we don't have much from him. Let's just make him eat a lot.
Sure.
Because he's hungry all the time. Goku characters is what we call them. His is like, I have to return the favor. I have to be a nice guy the entire time. That's it.
Oh.
You don't learn why.
Just nice.
Yeah, just wants nice. To be nice.
I have that on my end, too.
And every girl wants to fuck him.
Oh.
He's a fox. Oh,
okay.
He's like an actual fox.
Who, because, you know, what don't women like?
Because in my side, there's a ninja who's like, every woman's giving him gifts and wants to, like, make babies, and he's getting, like,
oh, man, there's kind of a ninja on the other side, too.
Yeah, and he's like, I don't understand. I'm just doing my job. Why? Who are these women? I don't get it.
Yeah, he doesn't, it's like that guy from 30 Rock where, like, women have always treated him nicely.
Yeah.
And, like, he doesn't actually know how hard life is because women have always
Yeah. And then your character...
Isn't it John Hamm?
It's John Hamm's character. Yeah, okay. Who thinks he can speak French because no one's told him
he can. Yeah, because no one's corrected.
Yeah, and your main character goes up to him and says, oh, you know, you should be proud. Most men would kill to have that much interaction with women. And he's like, I'd rather just do my job. Support level C.
And how did you... he just described his job to me.
So yeah, I think a lot of the characters are more shallow and, like, not as interesting. More tropey.
Sure.
It's...
Yeah, and I really hate how limited you are in making your main character.
Yeah.
Either don't let me, or give me a lot. Like, and and especially because Awakening had more. Because in Awakening, I made, like, a really old man commander.
Oh, that's awesome.
Or at least middle age. Yeah. And he looked tired. He was battle-worn, had, like, scars. And I was like, yeah, man, this is the dude that's going to go through war. He has a deep voice. This dude, you can't make a dude older than, like, 20.
Yeah.
Something, like
20-year-olds.
Even some of them, sometimes they'll look like they're fucking 15 or something.
Oh,
and
no.
It's bad.
Yeah, and then the skin tone, you can't even change?
Nope.
It can't change, no.
Fucking monster.
Just like Japanese white.
Sour cream, yeah.
Like,
this picnic's going terribly.
Yeah.
You fucking all the sunscreen.
And I didn't have a problem with Corrin's design in Smash for whatever reason, but now that I'm seeing it and playing the game more, I hate his armor.
Yeah.
I hate it. I can't stand the way he looks. He's wearing this skin-tight suit that just has metal plates on it.
Mm.
It looks very uncomfortable and not battle-ready.
Yeah. Yeah.
Doesn't wear shoes.
Yeah.
Like an asshole.
I just want to see you go to someone, like, even outdoor, like in a park or something. Yeah. You're such a piece of shit.
Not wearing shoes.
Put on shoes, you garbage.
Yeah.
This looking isn't asshole. Your den.
Like, not even a hippie thing. I just think they're,
just
some of the earth.
Publicly.
Yeah. So, I haven't played Awakening, so I don't have anything to compare it to recent.
Right. Yeah. I haven't beaten it yet, so I'm not going to give, like, my whole deep dive into Conquest.
Okay. Same. My best for me is just, like, okay. It's, like, a little out of place.
But yeah.
Overall, it's great. And, you know, that's pretty much my week. That's all I...
Oh, okay. Oh, really? Yeah.
That took a lot.
Or month, yeah. But...
Month, yeah.
What about you?
So Samurai Jack covered Fire Emblem because... I've been having finals and, like, papers and shit, and other stuff for channel that have just been kind of taking up a lot of time. So, Birthright Fire Emblem is just stuff I would play because I can play, like, a 30-minute session in between studying or whatever.
Yeah.
As for shows, I've now been watching a lot of shit. I just finished Iron Fist on Netflix.
I've heard nothing but bad things about it.
So... As a TV show on its own, it's fine. It's okay.
Okay.
It's not... Cool. Having said that, the fact that it's just okay...
Yeah.
Amongst the Marvel shows, which were the best things I think Marvel was pumping out, it's like... Compared to them, it's bad. Like...
Compared to Jessica Jones, which I think is
Jessica Jones
best...
to me is the high bar.
Yeah.
For me personally.
Yeah.
Although there are moments in Daredevil... Because there's stuff in Daredevil I would pick over Jessica Jones. Mm-hmm. As much as I like the purple guy... And the Birdman and Jessica Jones, I think Kingpin and Daredevil is one of my favorite villains.
Killed it, like Kingpin every time.
Vincent D'Onofrio, I think, fucking nails. He honestly steals that show. If every time he's on screen, it's everything's
deeply compelling.
About him.
So compelling.
Oh, yeah. From the first thing, his first line in the show is, "It makes me sad." That's your villain. And it's like, just, it goes off, and he's great. He's fantastic. Yeah. And the performance is like the best thing in the Marvel, like, and again, I still like Jessica Jones overall, but Kingpin's character is like the best character in the entire Marvel, like, TV universe. Even I would say the movies, because Marvel villains aren't that great in the movies, or at least very memorable. I guess save for Voltron. I mean, no, not Voltron. Ultron. But Ultron, it was a big disappointment for me. Because he starts off in this really interesting villain where he's discovering the concepts of, like, being alive. And immediately the next scene is him just be a standard Joss Whedon, smarmy, bad guy.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I've seen that done, like, hundreds of times before. Like, anyway.
We all watched Buffy.
Yeah, we all watched Buffy. Yeah, I think a lot of the things comes from Iron Fist just doesn't have its own identity.
True.
Because to me it seems like just a more toned back version of Daredevil. And that sucks, because Daredevil, Jessica Jones, and Luke Cage have their own personality.
Clearly defined, their wants, the way they do it.
The way, right down to the way the show is shot, to the writing, to the music choices, to how... just the feeling you would get in, like, dialogue. Or like, Jessica Jones has monologues. No other one does that, because Jessica Jones is a detective.
Noir detective.
Yeah, and it's a throwback to that.
Yeah.
Luke Cage has a lot of those racial tensions, because, again, it's Luke Cage.
1970, very 70s and horror colors.
Yeah. Daredevil has those has the courtroom scenes. Yes. And they're sometimes pretty well written. Yeah. And just ways to deal with law, because he's a lawyer.
Yeah.
Iron Fist is supposed to be a martial artist, and yes, there's fights, there's quite a bit. They're not that great, and they're nowhere near on the level of Daredevil. And they don't really talk about martial arts, it's more about a company.
It's what I've been told is that it's almost entirely about, like, this blonde dude trying to take his dad's company back.
Yeah, and you're not sure if he's gonna be the big bad, because there seems like there's... At the end of the show, there's like three big bads.
Oh, man.
Yeah, because none of them are that great.
There's the Hand, I know, is in it.
Yes.
That's not a spoiler, is it?
No. Because
that's like...
The only reason I said that is because something happens along the lines with them.
Oh, okay.
And Madame Gao is already previously established.
She's established in Daredevil. Both Luke Cage and Luke Cage, I think, both.
Well, yeah, she was more villain
than
Luke Cage. She's fully prevalent in this. Mm-mm. And she's fine.
Good actress.
She's good. No, she's good at what she's doing. She definitely is. She may be the strongest actor or, like, actress.
I've also heard good things about the girl who is in it, who has the sword.
Yes, she's great. What's her name? The dragon's daughter, or daughter of the dragon. She's good.
Yeah, I've heard good things about her.
Iron Fist is okay. It's just like, he's eh. He's nothing special. That's the whole problem with the show, is that it's nothing really special.
Yeah.
And every Marvel show has its own real special thing you like about
niche.
It.
It's specific. Like, Guardians of the Galaxy went real niche. Yeah. Real specific.
And it's still, like,
and that's why it's so
one
good.
Of my favorite ones. Right under Iron Man 1, I think Guardians of the Galaxy is, like, right there for me.
Yeah.
For Marvel movies.
So, here's one other thing I've heard, and I want to just get your feel on it.
Sure.
Is that I was told that the character Iron Fist... just, it seems like they don't know what he is. Like, is he a martial arts genius, or is he a smarmy jackass who just is quippy, or is he an unexperienced, like, kid, or is he, like, hiding how strong, like, he seems to change from scene to scene.
So I would say three of those things are things they try to do.
Okay.
The smarmy one and the snippy one, and not really, he doesn't, he's not the funny type. He's more innocence.
Okay.
And that's kind of where the humor comes from, is that.
Okay.
He's more innocent than anything. Yeah, he kind of has a weird identity crisis, especially because his character seems to change at the end, but I don't get why. It seems like they just wrote him that way instead of...
developing.
Because because the reasons you would assume that he acts like that in the later seasons, those reasons would be prevalent from the very beginning. And I don't know why. They don't kind of do it. And you would see why if you watched the show. Yeah, I think that's where that show fails, okay. is that it doesn't play off its own thing. It seems pretty generic. Mm. And the fights, there's a handful of good ones, and I think there's one really solid one. Mm. But it's Iron Fist. Those fight scenes should be awesome martial arts.
Right.
Movies. And in fact, that's what I thought the feeling was going to be. They're this unique feeling. Like I thought they were going to harken back to all, yeah, martial arts movies, yeah. some, maybe some even dumber shit, like bad, like, English subtitles. Like, well, that's just me.
Yeah.
Hoping for shit.
I mean, I
but I would have rather had that feeling. Like, and this is just, it seems like a regular television show.
Yeah.
And that sucks.
That's a shame.
Yeah, I was really disappointed, because I wanted Iron Fist to be amazing. I wanted it to be, like, these awesome, kick-ass martial arts fights.
I had kind of imagined in my mind that they were going to do, like a... you know that scene? This is what I was picturing. That scene where Jackie Chan is being chased by, like, six guys, and he climbs up the scaffolding of a not-built building? That's what I was imagining.
Fuck, dude, that would have been cool. Yeah, that doesn't
That happen. Doesn't... That's too bad. That sucks.
It really does, doesn't it? Because, like, even I'm like, you can do so many things with this if you just go along the martial arts niche.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot. There's, like, a rich history of this shit, man. Especially, like, now where Donnie Yen is bringing that back with movies like Ip Man. You could do stuff from that.
Yeah.
But they don't.
Or the, what's that one where he's in the top of an apartment building and the raid.
Oh, fuck, dude. Okay, I would have loved if they did a raid thing, but, I mean, this show's okay. It's still better than most generic TV shows.
Sure, just disappointing.
It's incredibly disappointing. It's, because it had a lot of potential, and none of it was utilized.
That's a shame.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it's a downright bad show, although there's parts in it that I think are poor choices and are bad choices for writing. Mm-hmm. But it's nothing special, okay. I think. And that sucks.
Yeah.
So I watched that.
Mm-hmm.
What else? I watched another entire series. Oh, I watched season 2 of Love, the Judd Apatow.
How's that?
Show. Oh. Why, have you seen it?
I've seen parts of it. I haven't seen the whole thing.
Okay, what do you think?
I can't watch it.
Why?
I can't fucking watch that real? Show. No, the people, I can't deal with those people.
Oh, you can't stand them? Okay.
They're not my, I don't know, how do you feel about it? You tell me how you feel about it.
That's a very, because that's a very specific.
Because I can't fucking stand listening to those people talk to each other.
Oh, okay.
Because they're written
okay.
so well as assholes.
They're
that you can't
just
stand.
Such bad, they're pieces of shit and I hate
them. Oh, yeah, yeah, they're all really bad people. Like, they're all real shitty people. Especially the main characters are real shitty.
They're such pieces of shit, I don't know what. But I just keep thinking, am I supposed to like these fucking people?
Yeah.
Like, what are you supposed to feel? Like,
how am I supposed to feel? I feel like I want their destruction.
So here's the thing I would say to that, right? Like, so what I think they wanted to go with is these two people have never been, like, truly in love.
Okay.
Hence the show name Love. Mm. But, and they would start learning from then on. But I think where your problem stems from is that I think he went a little too far back.
Okay.
On that meter for a little bit of more common sense or at least
sure.
human empathy.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Because there's bits of it even I'm like I've never been truly in love because I'm a cold, heartless person who only likes broken people.
Sure.
And I'm like, no, can you just be empathetic or at least not
like, be a total piece of shit? Because
if you're trying to go for the real person angle,
yeah.
which I think is what they're trying to go for
right.
in the show. Then I think a real person would actually understand what's that.
On some level. Like,
right?
You don't have to have been in love to not treat people
I'll
like
tell you,
fucking
I'll tell
garbage.
You now, in the second season, they get over a lot of that stuff.
Okay.
And they're starting to get better at it.
Okay.
Which is kind of where I'm seeing. Which is kind of what's keeping me in the show.
Okay.
Is that I think they're progressing as people. And, like, they're actually becoming decent human beings towards the end.
Oh.
Well. And then something happens, but they're gonna work on it and get in there. Yeah,
we're working on it.
Plus there's some humor bits that I truly do like. A lot of the side characters are really good.
Mm-hmm.
And then they made one character like they just added this whole thing with him, which I didn't think he would get as much playtime as he did at least from the previous one. I think the show's good. I think it's entertaining. I can see though. Where your complaints aren't. What else? Man, we saw Get Out. I still have to watch Kong. I'm gonna watch it tomorrow. Mm-hmm. I know, because I mentioned before how much of a big Godzilla fan.
Yes.
I've heard good things about Kong, and I want it to be really good, because if it is, Legendary's going to go through with their plan of crossing over Godzilla and Kong in that movie, and that's something Chris Jr. needs in his lifetime.
I mean, I know that they have been planting seeds for the Bryan Cranston Godzilla, this movie, and other ones to become one connected
The universe. Ultimate thing is going to be getting Pacific Rim and Godzilla to cross.
No, you don't think they're going to do it. I don't think
that. I think they might? Because if Pacific Rim 2, it's going to happen.
That's true.
Now it's finally back on board.
Finally happened.
Because they laid out their whole monster cinematic universe.
Yeah.
You know, it was around that time everyone was trying to make their own cinematic universe.
Yeah.
Because Marvel was doing it so well. So they're trying to do it with these giant monsters.
I mean, I won't lie. It's probably going to make some pretty good monster movies.
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, I thought the Legendary Godzilla was really good.
If they're all connected, that's a really shitty world to live in. There's monsters inside.
Like, but what, is it any better than the Marvel like movie where New York is destroyed and leveled?
Well, no, every single movie. Because it's the cities. Like, we're talking about, like, these monsters are underground.
Yeah, in the Marvel world, if you just, like, move to Montana, you'll be fine. No one goes there.
Oh, there's, like, I forgot what comedy that's from, but there's one real great thing where there's this new villain starting up, and then he's like, yeah, and I'm going to be... And he's there, like, where are you going to be? Yeah, well, I live in New York, so I'm going to have... And then he's going to go, why are you going to fucking... fight in New York? And like, it's a superhero telling him this. He's like, every block has your own fucking villain. Why would you ever want to be a villain in New York? Go to like Dakota or something. Yeah. No one's gonna stop you. And I love that. It's like, I know it's a superhero telling him this.
Yeah.
And I forget exactly what the context is.
Just the idea. Even better, go to Alaska and take over all the oil fields.
Yeah.
Oh, I control all the fuel to the country.
Yeah. Maybe if you just thought about it more than none.
Yes. If you gave it even a minute of thought.
Yeah, you could figure something out.
Oh, you have subterranean monsters? Why don't you go to literally Texas?
Yeah.
And there's like 50% of Texas no one fucking lives in.
Can build a base. Yeah, like shit like that. Yeah. I want the Kong movie to be good, so I'm gonna watch that tomorrow.
Cool.
I have to watch John Wick 2.
Yeah,
I heard it's pretty good. I heard it's really good. Have you seen it?
Yeah.
Is it good?
Okay. It's pretty great. It's hard to build on guy kills everybody.
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. Here's what I was telling people. That I think, because the appeal of John Wick, the first John Wick, initially is that all the choreography is fucking great.
It's beautiful.
It's really great. But the thing that kept me and made me go, this thing knows, like, what action movies are, is the character John Wick is this retired action hero.
Yeah.
And everyone knows how big his dick is.
Yeah.
And to the point where the villains in the movie go, we're not going to win. This is... In fact, we had no plan of ever interacting with this guy ever again.
Mm-hmm.
We had mutual understanding until this one guy came and fucked it up. And we, like, hate this guy now.
Yeah.
And then also there's a whole secret society that's only ever hinted at.
Yes.
Like, I think in three scenes in the movie.
Yes.
But it's heavily implied that there's a secret society going on.
That makes me think of it. Do we have time to talk about one other thing?
Sure.
Other movie?
Sure.
So, a while ago, there was a film that came out called Now You See Me Too.
Okay.
It starred Daniel Radcliffe, beautiful star of the stream. Mm-hmm. But so in that movie,
that's the magician one, right?
That's the magician one. Yeah. Where they don't ever really explain, like, is it magic or are they just like con men who are good at magic tricks?
Yeah.
They in the sequel still do not explain that.
Really.
So, like, the film has Morgan Freeman in it, and it has Woody Harrelson playing twins, and it's got a lot going on for it.
Okay.
But what you need to understand is, first of all, the sequel just basically retcons a whole bunch of shit. They write out the female lead, because she didn't want to be in it. They put a new one in like 5 minutes, and they're just like, you're gonna love her now! And they also, like, just undo a lot of the motivations of, like Morgan Freeman was a professional magician debunker.
Okay.
Who Mark Ruffalo gets out of prison just with, like, a pass. He's like, I need him out of jail to take him to Hong Kong. Well, okay, Mark Ruffalo. Your eyes are dreamy.
So
there's so much weird shit going on, and they periodically keep making reference to, like, the secret society that Jesse Eisenberg's dad was a part of, or something such. And then, I'm gonna ruin the end of it, so get ready.
Okay, so how long are you
gonna be? It's gonna be, like, 5 minutes, or less.
Okay, so skip to 5 minutes or less.
So the end of the movie, it turns out, like, all the people that they conned, with the exception of Daniel Radcliffe, and it turns out his dad, played by Michael Caine, isn't dead. With the exception of them, everyone was working with them, like, which means, like, the seven Chinese actors who are in the film were like, we were double agents the whole time! Ha ha ha! And there's, like, this secret castle in England, and it's just like, so is, like, magic real? Or, like, that's not clear? The characters are like, that's not been made clear to me. Is magic real? And they're just like, come into the basement. And then you just get the shot of them from the bottom of a spiral staircase, looking up at them. And, like, their faces all make that face like the Big Lebowski when he's going down that bowling alley.
Yeah.
And then they run down the staircase. End of film! Unacceptable end of film! Unacceptable!
No, see, you don't get it. The Now You See Me cinematic universe was supposed to take off.
And now they're clearly implying that, like, well, we're gonna make a third one. We're gonna make a third one and then tease you if magic's real still. Sick shit. You can stop skipping. But you, God damn it. God damn it. I'm very upset.
You're so invested in it.
I've watched all of them.
All two of them?
All of them. I'm furious. I've watched I've watched Dave Franco struggle his way through Chinese lines. This is ridiculous. Oh my god. So, secret societies. It made me think of that. Jesus Christ, teasing a secret. Tell us!
Yeah, I want to see John Wick 2.
But John Wick 2 is a great film. John Wick 2 I want to
watch. There is another movie I do want to watch. That might not even be in theaters anymore, but...
what was it?
Well, fuck, now there's like two other ones. Because like Logan? I also want to watch... Yeah, Logan. I want to watch Logan. Okay. Mm-hmm. I want to watch the Belko Experiment.
Okay.
Because it's James Gunn directing it.
James Gunn, yeah. He made it actually a while ago, didn't he? And it kind of took a while to come out, is my understanding.
Yeah, something along those lines. Yeah. To get distributed or somewhere. Because it's pretty... It's this weird in-between, between like a big budget to just an indie film. I want to check it out. Hopefully it's good. I mean, it's another death game thing. And a lot of things with those stories, it's very hard to justify why it's a fucking death game.
Yeah.
So I want that's going to be the real curiosity for this, how he does it.
See how it works.
Yeah. Because Battle Royale has that problem. The Hunger Games has that problem. Pretty much any death game story I could ever think of has that problem of... The only one that kind of doesn't, but yet does at the exact same time, is Danganronpa. Because the world, at least for what you learn, is actually fairly interesting because it might be post-apocalyptic, and there's legitimately reasons for this. We still don't know the entire thing. We're gonna wait till the third game, and then we'll find out. So what else? Been playing Nier Automata, as I touched upon.
Yes.
Yo, that game's fantastic. That game's really good. I think the gameplay's great. It's not as deep as most Platinum games are. It's no Bayonetta. It's closer to Revengeance, but it's still not as like deep as Revengeance is. The combat's still great. I think the writing's fantastic. It's one of the most interesting, compelling worlds I've seen in a video game in a long time. It's one of those things where I'm going through it, and me and Nick are like watching stuff play out, and we're just wondering how each thing works. But having said that, I think it's only so because me and Nick know the full story coming up beforehand. We're talking all the way back to Drakengard 1. So, what I would recommend to people who really want to get into that game, before you do, go check out, specifically, I would recommend Mr. Klemp's videos to summarize pretty much every important thing that happens.
Yeah.
Because he does it from Drakengard 1 all the way to Nier. And when I watched all those videos, I felt fucking caught up. I felt like I wasn't missing anything. And then I'd also recommend to watch Super Bunny Hop because he touches upon the weirder shit. Like, there was a stage play done once by an idol group in Japan that explains why aliens invaded Earth, which you find out, which they just mentioned there's aliens in Nier Automata. So, and then they're called the Yorha Directive. Which, and then, like, there's all this other stuff. There's audio CDs. There's, like, little short stories. But Mr. Clem's videos, I think, are enough.
Yeah.
Along with Super Bunny Hop.
Yeah, I think it's funny because I remember when Automata came out, the day it came out, a friend of mine asked me, hey, I'm deciding whether to get Horizon Zero Dawn or Nier Automata. And I asked him, have you played any of the Nier games? He said, oh, it's a series? And he's like,
oh, wow.
I said, yeah, it's a series, actually. It's a very long series. And he's like,
we're talking PS2.
PS2 era,
like,
yeah.
Early PS2.
Yeah. And he's like, oh, but it's just, like, girls who just fight androids, right? And robots? And I was sitting there, like...
It's a fucking lot. Like, it's Shankar a... one's one big buff dude in, like, medieval who rides a dragon. And, like, babies come down in, like, a Neon Genesis. In fact, there's a specific ending that he said, that Yokotaro said was inspired by the end of Evangelion.
It's been a bunch of...
Specifically those two episodes.
The ones where a bunch of girls appear and then everyone becomes goo?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Dragon Guard, is it 3 where one of your side characters is eats children?
Yeah.
That's one.
In Dragon Guard 1, there's an implied pedophile. Ugh. And the most controversial character in, like, any video game I've seen.
Wow.
There's Dragon Guard 2 is probably the weakest one. Well, story-wise. Because it's, like, lighthearted. Dragon Guard 3 has one of the coolest endings, though.
Yeah, it sucks.
And that's where the androids come from. And, like, yeah. Go watch those Mystery Clems videos. Because I think Nier Automata is worth your time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think more people should buy it. Because, again, it's one of the most fascinating worlds I've seen in video games.
Mm.
One of.
Yeah.
It's fantastic. That game's fantastic. Honestly, and it has that nice platinum action touch where you get some scenes that are just fucking dope.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, the gameplay's solid, I think. So that's pretty much it. Other than, like, fucking... essays and just school shit. School shit's not important. Yeah. Work and fucking. Yeah! So, that's pretty much it. I can't think of anything else.
For sure.
I'm still reading Norse mythology. So
the new Gaten book. Yeah.
It's because I've still been doing stuff between that. So, I gotta finish that.
For sure.
Yeah.
We may or may not be doing something on this. Well, hopefully the episode will be out, but I'm not going to say anything for sure because anything could change between when this episode was recorded and when it airs. Okay. What? All right. Wow. So we want to go around telling a story if you want.
Would you? Or I? Okay, I'll go.
Yeah.
I thought you didn't have one. It's perfectly okay. We can just say fuck it and call this the Get Out spoiler cast.
And just start talking about all the racial satire.
Fuck, man.
Social satire. Man, you know what? Fuck it. You want to do that?
You want to talk about Get Out?
You want to talk about Get Out from here on out?
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
I had a story, but I'll save it for next time.
Yeah. Because I want to talk about Get Out.
All right.
Okay.
The guy's black.
So here's how we get... Well, Nick. So, here's where we're going to go do this. Future Chris is going to put a little thing in here, insert here, that tells you exactly what time stamp to skip to, in case there's anything after.
Mm.
So, we're going to talk about Get Out now. Okay, so that movie's great. That movie's like...
Yeah, race war.
No, okay, so here's the thing, it's not just racism, the movie.
I just want to start with,
it's a very specific niche in that it's a white girlfriend and a black boyfriend.
Mm-hmm.
And there are details. In fact, the first line the main character has is, do your parents know I'm black? That's such important, like, I've seen it before, like, and again, should we say what our races are, like, in case that's pertinent?
Brown.
Yeah.
Light brown.
Well, Hispanic.
But shades of brown.
Hispanic specifically growing up in the LA area.
Like, if you go to Lowe's and you find a shade of paint you want to get, light brown. Yeah.
Have you ever seen khakis? Yeah. Kind of like that.
And you're like double. You got Jewish thing going on. What? Man, it's so weird. Jewish thing's like a race. Oh, like, yeah. It's so that? Weird that the Jews are a race. Well, I mean, it's like a race. Oh, because it's like a religion, but like, we might as well, might like, as people well. Might as well consider it. Yeah, that's yeah. A, it's terrible. It's a terrible world we live in. And I am here for your, the injustice you suffer.
Yeah, yeah, no, get out, yeah.
Okay, bye.
Yeah. So, of course, none of us are going to have the exact same experience on that.
No.
Because
no.
Of course not. We're not going to claim to.
No, anything. None of us are claiming that.
Yeah, I'm not in a relationship.
As someone, we are only claiming to be people who, from the outside, are observing what we think the artist is trying to say mm-hmm. and our interpretation of.
And we can, of course, relate that with stuff we felt. In our own like, sure. being Hispanic on this.
Sure. Part. Yeah. Yeah.
Because there are, like, weird there nuances are weird... to Hispanic. Yeah, because yeah. There's even, like, stuff within Chicano, Hispanic, wherein... like, Latino or Latina.
Yeah.
Because there's different words for different reasons. Hispanic is just Mexican-American in any sort of sense. Chicano is this weird, very specific, raised in L.A., but in very specific parts.
Sure.
Mexican-heavy communities. Latin is just any Latin...
Anything American from country. From like below America down.
Yeah, more even Puerto Rico is like considered Latin America.
Yeah.
And there's weird tensions in between those sometimes.
We all have very complicated relationships with each other.
Yeah, because it's like that. It's this thing where I know where if you go into Mexico, they sometimes look down on people like Hispanics who live in America.
In certain other, yeah.
Whereas we even... It's just weird, like, little things.
And then, I mean, you also have things like, not to turn this into a different kind of story, but like, I know lots of people who have had the experience of, like, grandparents or family members who live, who either lived or are very tied to their old country origins, mm-hmm. be that Mexico or Venezuela or whatever, or Ecuador, mm-hmm. and they have that weird thing of, I'm tying it back to the movie, wherein they'll say weird shit like, "Oh, your son is so handsome. He's so very white. He has such a European nose. He's beautiful."
Yeah, just as weird, and that's bringing it to the movie.
Yeah, that's
a lot. That's where a lot of those things like start really taking form because there's this nice. That's I think one of the things the movie does best is this nice escalation.
It does slowly build.
Not the knob's not at like 11 or 10 at. Like the very start. In fact, I wouldn't even say it's at like 7 or 8. It starts at a very low thing. It gets up low as soon as he said, "Hey, do your folks know?"
Yeah,
but it keeps going until
then. The policeman, and then the brother.
The policeman scene's fucking genius because it's not because the first time you see that, you think it's her saying it's
standing up for him.
Yeah, but it's not.
She doesn't want a paper trail.
She doesn't want a paper trail. She doesn't want them checking out their house.
Yeah.
She doesn't want a report of the boyfriend alive or in this area at the time. It's very like there's incredible scenes. Even the deer scene, which is the first thing you see with the character, like something kind of wrong going.
Yeah,
and it's kind of weird at the beginning because it's just it seems like they're just doing that. Oh, deer are evil type imagery that you see in like shows like Hannibal or whatever.
Yes.
And okay, we're just gonna pursue that, but no, it's him remembering his mother at the time.
Yeah.
Of leaving her in the rain to die.
Yeah. As a small child, it's not like if you haven't seen it, it's not like if you haven't seen it, fuck you.
No, but if you haven't listening seen it, to you're this. Not you're not in this conversation.
But like the. Jesus, and I think the part for me that where I was like, "Oh, this is really terrible," is the first scene where it's just him and the mother.
Mm-hmm.
You remember that scene?
Yeah,
where she, the scene starts with, "Have you smoked in front of my daughter?"
Yeah,
yeah,
and
just becomes really uncomfortable really fast.
Yeah. Well, that's the first scene they get alone time, and that's the first scene something's going wrong.
Really wrong.
Well, really wrong.
Well, I was going to add, that kind of reminds me, I remember I watched that, it reminded me of a story a friend of mine told when he brought a girl, when like his family from El Salvador moved here.
Yeah.
To move out from, you know, like that was like when, like, that was like the height of the murder and the murder rates. Yeah. He says so. They like immediately like get the fuck out of here. Let's go.
Yeah.
And
that's weird. Actually, I just met some guy
from El Salvador.
From a class. Yeah, from a class. My drama fiction class. He's from El Salvador. Mm-hmm. So, like,
yeah. No.
And I think he brought that up at one point, but yeah.
That's just not very safe. Right
he didn't
now.
Touch upon it further.
Yeah. But yeah, no. It just reminded me of a story like with the whole in the scenes with the family tensions in the beginning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The racial tension. It kind of reminded me of the story my friend was telling me about, like, his mother would be really suspicious of the girlfriends that that he would bring home, who were Mexican,
right?
Who were either Mexican or were like any descent. Like her mother would
anyone that's not El Salvadorian, or
it's kind of the thing of like he explained like the whole thing of like how Mexico is like trying to push anybody. Like, who's Salvadorian away? Because
right. Yeah.
of MS-13 smuggling.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's happening.
Yeah.
So, she gets, like, she kind of, he talked about how, like, she, the mother asks, specific types of questions.
Oh.
That are really, like, out of nowhere, or kind of, like, that's really unnecessary.
Very pointed.
Yeah, so I kind of, like, the cigarette scene, like, that's really an intense, like,
yeah.
unnecessary question. So, yeah. It's like, it's trying to push, like, is she going to tell her parents, the girlfriend, that... She's dating a Salvadorian, and is the girlfriend's parents gonna think that she's dating a criminal?
Right.
Because of all that, but I don't know. That's the first thing that came to mind when I was watching it. So I guess that's where I saw. That's what I saw from.
Okay.
The other thing I was thinking about. So going back further in the film,
sure.
when they have the first dinner, the family dinner together,
yeah.
and that's where you meet
the brother.
Who,
if anyone's going to have a fucking Ku Klux Klan hood...
It's probably that guy.
It's that guy.
Yeah, it's that guy. He actually made me think more about, like... Sorry. He made me think more about, he was very bro-y.
Yeah.
And I feel like he was, like... Oh, gosh. Just the worst fucking kind of guy.
Yeah.
Like, he's the kind of guy who, like, would beat someone up and then be like, what are you being fucking bitch about it?
Yeah,
But... There, so there's
and
that.
He's like one of the bigger red herrings that happened in the earlier movie because it's supposed to get you thinking, yeah, this movie is black people or anything like that. But then there's very specific word choice in that your muscle structure is there.
See, that's the thing is like and the film does this really well is that there is this racism that it's tackling specifically that is this idea of. Well, I can't be racist. I don't hate black people. I, in fact, think they're better.
Yeah, it's a weird fetishization. It's
fetishization, too much, yeah.
Of them, in that they are the superior.
They're genetically superior
in physical aspects.
Their bones and such. And then it ties into the Jesse Owens thing.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Of, oh, this is a picture of my pop. Yeah, he almost got into the 52 Olympics.
Yeah.
Beat out by Jesse Owens
Which, that's great. Because you find out later that the grandfather is in the body of the groundskeeper.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's why he's running.
Why he's
at every morning because he wants to feel that speed and be faster.
Yeah.
Win that gold medal.
Fuck, man.
It's genius little inputs, and they don't say any of that stuff like outright.
And then they also have that line immediately after you see a picture of the quote dead grandfather on the wall. He's just like. Yeah, we revamped. It's something that we revamped the kitchen. My mother really loved this place. I like to think there's still a little part of her inside of it. And you immediately meet the maid, who is actually the grandmother.
Which, by the way, someone pointed this out on another podcast I was listening to. When she spills the tea, I thought it was just some weird thing of her doing. Uh-huh. But she spills the tea in reaction to the spoon hitting the cup for the first time. And that's where you get that little hint of there's two people inside the body, just one. Which, by the way, I love that there's two people inside a body, except one, because I think that's more interesting than just having a pilot.
Taken over.
Yeah.
Let's go through more of the plot points, and then we can talk about themes, because there's so much themes.
There's so much, and we're kind of jumping around.
Yeah.
So let's take it from the beginning. So we were at the deer scene.
The deer scene.
At the very beginning.
Yes.
And they get to the house.
Yeah.
And of course, my father begins with that line. I would have voted for Obama
for a third term. It would have been yeah.
Which is again, it's one of those things where it brings up people who weren't like raised around any black person, and just don't know quite how to talk,
how to handle it.
And in fact, that's all they focus on. Whereas,
rather than trying to connect them on a human level, about the photography, where I think he has a camera around his neck at the beginning, does he?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And nobody talks about it.
Yeah.
No one brings that up
because they're all focused
on his race.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's the little lines come into that. That's, again, a very specific thing.
Yeah.
In there. It's like, I mean, I've had those kinds of experiences before. It happens more as I got older, where especially like college, mm-hmm. and like people notice, I had once some dude assume I was Arabic.
Really?
Like touring for a college. Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I guess he pointed out like the beard or maybe like beard. Mm-hmm. I went, oh, that's weird. Well, I'm Hispanic.
Yeah.
All this stuff. He's like, oh, okay. Well, I'm just saying people would assume.
Oh.
And I went, okay. Yeah, man. That's cool. And like, no, I'm getting, and it's me going, no, I get it. And it's one of those like things you use to disarm conversations.
Yeah,
so you don't have to talk about your own race. Yeah. It happens more in college. Well, didn't happen too much to me because the college I go to is still in the Southern California area.
Yeah.
So
the chances,
it's still pretty heavily Hispanic.
Yeah.
Or at least people grew up around that. It's usually you meet someone.
If you're in California, with the exception of Orange County, the chances that something bad will happen as a Hispanic person is pretty low.
Yeah.
Like, the chances of being, I guess, looked down upon for being Latino in some way, that doesn't happen that much.
No.
But, I mean,
that's... like the higher valley stuff.
Yeah.
The richer area.
We're not saying who, we're just saying certain areas... It tends to... Certain areas also do this thing that... I know it doesn't bother everyone, but...
Oh, sorry. I just came up with a perfect example of me being like...
Go ahead.
They don't know how to talk to a Hispanic
person. Go ahead.
I was hanging out with these people one time at my college. And people were like, well, what are we going to do for dinners? And like, someone's like, man, you know what? I want empanadas. And the guy's white. Yeah. And then he looks to me as soon as he says that. And then I went... But like, he wasn't doing it as if he was going... empanadas, like he was saying, like, so weird, thing. But I noticed he looked at me as soon as he said it.
Like, you know this.
You know what
this
empanadas are.
You know.
And then someone goes, "Where are empanadas?" And he's still leaving. He's like, "Ah, well, hey, Chris, you want to leave?" And then I went, "Why? Why? Why do I want to explain it?" I just thought you mean, really.
Really?
Well, okay. So I went on to explain. I went, there, man. Yeah, glad I can help.
Man, what friends?
What friends? Yeah, you know what? I barely consider
friends. You ditched them.
I do ditch. Oh, well, yeah. Well, that's personal shit. It's like, it's that kind of thing. Where
it is
they don't know how to talk. Like,
they don't know how to talk about it. And by trying to make you feel at ease, they make you feel more uncomfortable.
Yeah, yeah.
By trying, like... Well,
and maybe you can just stop, it's a classic, my eyes are up here, type deal.
It's a very frequent, if I could use a completely different group to make an example, because I have seen this happen, and it was really, as a third party.
As a third party,
and it was very awkward.
Okay.
I was at a party, and there was a brother and sister who were East Indian, kind of from that South Asia area.
Uh-huh.
And so, at some point... almost the exact same thing. You could see there was this girl talking. She wanted to include these people in the conversation.
Uh-huh.
They were talking about they were talking about cooking. They were talking about food, because food is a safe subject generally.
Yeah, everyone loves food.
Yeah, and you
if
could
if you don't, you're fucking weirdo.
Like, yeah,
how are you even alive?
How are you alive?
Weird.
Yeah. But so it's the exact same thing. She knows nothing about that culture or those people, and she's not familiar with people from that culture, and so. She draws on the only things she knows, and she's like, "Curry's really good, right? Who likes curry?
Yeah,
isn't that delicious? It has rice, I believe.
You guys like sushi?"
The brother should have been like, "I fucking love it." Like, tattooed on his chest, curry. Tattooed on his chest, all curry.
That's fucking terrible.
But yeah, it's that thing of no one. It's not done maliciously. It's not done.
It's done because they don't know. It's more arrogance.
It's ignorance and arrogance about trying to well, here's my one thing I know. Yeah. Let me take this out.
Yeah, but it's still a form of racism because you're not talking to them on a human level. Yeah. You're still so focused on their race.
Race, yeah.
Absolutely. And that's kind of, again, that's what this movie very touched on. And in fact, the whole father, like, is basically that person all in one.
Yeah.
Pretty much every, the goofy dad, he's like, trying to relate in every way.
Who has just nothing. He's got nothing.
You know, he, like, the way they start off his character is, like, you know he has good intentions.
Yeah.
You know, despair. He just doesn't know.
Doesn't get it.
He doesn't get it. Mm-hmm. It's not malicious, but it's still a form of it.
Yes.
And, like, they go, and going into that, the whole psychology thing after... let's go with the dinner scene. Yes, the brother is the person, if anyone would have.
That weird,
like... He's so aggressive, like, it so just keeps, he keeps going and, like, puts it on.
And that weird, like, lean into him and...
So what sports do you play?
Do you know, he asks him basketball first, and then does he ask him MMA? He asks him MMA first.
No. Well, so what, the way the conversation goes, he says, what sports are you into?
Yeah.
And he just says, well, basketball. Like, but then he's like, MMA, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And that's where you get the, is this about a weird fight thing? Where,
like,
they,
masculinity defined by, like, I'm going to dominate your body with my body.
Yeah, because we don't even know if it's, like, a person within a person at that point. So, where the mind goes is that they're capturing these people to fight, like, because they're talking about dominant or structures.
Yeah.
That whole thing.
That whole weird thing.
Yeah.
And then later on in the thing, and...
Which, by the way, that movie also has one of the dumbest jump scares I've seen, but works so well because Peele knows how jump scares work.
Which one?
Where it's just grandmother walking by.
Oh yeah.
And then there's just that loud noise.
Yeah.
Goes on. It got everyone in our theater, me and Nick watched it.
Yeah.
But nothing happens.
No.
It's just a loud noise that gets you after real thing. So I thought that was just, like, a nice little
throw in.
Yeah, joke. Yeah. About jump scares. Because really there's no jump scares.
No.
Yeah, this movie, it's more just
tension.
The real horror, it comes from just feeling uncomfortable from the get-go. Like, of just everything being said, and it kind of building and building.
Yeah, man. Okay, so...
So we're at
the party?
Oh, no, hang on. Okay. There's the psychology thing I still want to talk about.
Okay.
Because we already talked about the running. What a good image, like, for how being within
a subdued body works.
You're all the way in the back, subdued. You're still in your body, but you just see it as this far off screen.
Distant, yeah.
Thing. You know what's happening, but you can't do anything about it.
Yeah.
It's such a good image for relaying how you later find out them being within bodies, like,
is like
work.
Yeah.
So it's real. I think that's really well. So now we can talk about the garbage, unless someone else has.
Do you want to talk about anything before the party?
No, I just think that again, it's the whole tension building, and then when that scene happens, when he sinks.
Yeah.
And then it shows for the first time. That's like, it really sets of, oh no, this is not really...
This is not a safe place.
This is bad. This is really, really bad. And I think that was brilliant. As Chris said, just of conveying of someone, just watching...
Taking their power away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he...
We're not even getting into how good all the actors are.
I was just going to say...
Like, there's so much good acting in this movie.
Shout out to him. He apparently did the crying for real.
Yeah, that I did hear about. That's awesome. That's tough.
That's amazing.
Because he has to be completely still and wide open.
And not blink for such a long shot.
Yeah.
That's such a long shot without cutting.
For sure.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Well, so he acts super well. I think the dad's really good at what he does. Even the grandmother and the grandfather... And they're, because those actors have to be these
conveying people who are, so much, yeah.
Yeah, who are, no, everything's fine, while still being white. But also conveying of, I have to be hiding that I'm actually white in a black person's body.
Yeah.
And also, there's this underlying...
Real self.
Yeah, real self that's in there that's trying to get out.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'll talk about the girlfriend, but I want to...
I want to talk about the girlfriend because she has one of the most amazing acting scenes I've seen in anything, but we'll get to that.
We'll get to that.
Okay. Because I need to know if that's real. Because there's a way that, in my head, I know there's a way you could fake that. I need to know she did it for real.
Okay.
And we'll get to that specific scene.
Mm-hmm.
So the garden party.
The garden party.
Which is probably the best.
Which is just so... Beautifully, again, beautifully shot. I can't talk about how
beautifully shot
that everything is.
That scene is. And then we just go through this montage of people, again, doing what the family has done. Said vaguely creepy, weird...
Well, they feel them up, literally, sometimes.
They grab his muscles. There's one woman
who's just feeling him up on his arm.
And then at some point asks him, is it true what they say about black men's dicks?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, like, the both of them, like a real person, is like, I don't know what the fuck to say to that old lady.
Okay, and then they, like... And he does go, And then there's that one thing they really point out, that I've noticed before happened to me, where it could retain anyone. But in this party and just sea of white people and white faces where he's the only race here, he naturally gravitates towards the one other black person
who
he sees.
Can relate to him in some way.
And he's ready to go, hey, like, now I can finally talk to someone. But he turns around and he can't reciprocate that because it is a white person hiding in a black person's body. And, like, just to me, that's the realization of, oh man, what if that does go wrong? Because I've been to parties before where I go, I don't relate to any of these people.
Yeah.
Either for whatever reason. Maybe I do, maybe it is because I'm the darkest one there and I try to find someone who is also Hispanic or something. Yeah. Or simple as I'm like the only nerd here. Everyone's talking about sports. Let me go find some dude. I don't care. We'll talk about Madden, bro. Let's just like any video game you want to. Like, as long as it's not sports.
Can we talk about also in that same scene, there's...
Well, sorry, can I finish?
Oh, good, please.
Like, how broken I would be to find out, oh my god, it didn't work. Yeah. This person's still like turning around talking
just
about sports.
Hollow.
Just sports hollow. And,
oh
like,
my god.
Oh, you don't watch movies, okay, even though you're wearing whatever. It's like like and that scene's great. He also has a great like performance in there.
He does. Mm-hmm. And there's so much tragedy I feel for that particular character. I mean, all of them.
All of them are tragic.
But that guy, I feel. But so there's a scene where they're back on the patio.
Yeah,
right? They're all talking, and there's
we did skip that scene. Yeah, so like, go into it.
And there's this guy who asks. No. This is still at the party.
Oh, is it okay? Go ahead.
It's still at the party. They're on the patio, and this old guy is just like, so how would you characterize the black experience? Positive, negative?
Yeah. Which, by the way, it's a Japanese guy.
It's a Japanese
guy. Says that.
Yeah, yeah.
Only
so non-white.
Another red herring.
Yes.
That this isn't a malicious like.
Yes.
This isn't. Well, it is malicious in a different, but not the sense people were thinking at the time.
Yeah.
In that it's just pure white supremacy,
supremacy
over that. Ooh, also, the other black person in the thing is another red herring. For that.
Yes.
There's a lot of like,
I don't
know what's going on
exactly.
like anymore.
Yeah.
And he's the one that asks,
positive, negative, net positive, net negative. Yeah. And he turns it around and he's like, I don't know. What do you think?
What do you think
of the black experience?
And then he's a jazz musician.
He's an ex, when he was a jazz musician.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they say he was an ex jazz musician.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just gonna call him the Andre 3000 looking guy because
he's dressed up in that hat.
He
does have that.
He has that hat and nice like suit
kind
of like pastel colored.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Well,
I've enjoyed the African American experience immensely.
And by the way, I loved his voice for doing that.
They all did like very convincing. Like it's surprising how much their voice changes.
Yeah. All real good performances. His singing and then him just screaming.
Get out. Freaking out, bleeding, hemorrhaging out the nose and shit.
And him screaming out, get out. Which, again, at this point, you don't know if that's him just being crazy and, like, attacking the dude, telling him to get out from away from me.
Right.
Or to get out of the house. It's like a real compelling scene.
It is.
And then it's followed by perhaps my favorite scene in the movie, although I'm still, like, thinking about it, where he decides to walk upstairs.
And
when he walks upstairs, everyone is quiet.
Immediately stops and
is watching his footsteps as he's going around.
Oh, Jesus.
It's one of the most disturbing scenes, like, in the thing. Because
now
there's a visual, hard confirmation.
Something is wrong.
This is about him.
Yeah.
This is something. Yeah. They're not just white people who don't know how to talk to other races or anything like that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, and then the maid scene's also really good.
Her performance is... Oh, shit. I'm feeling bad for her again, because, like, oh, my God. Just every single... The scene wherein, like, he's like, oh, my phone's unplugged, so on and so forth. And then she
goes, it's unplugged for the third time.
She goes to kind of apologize.
Yeah.
And then you just see her just streaming with tears. Mm-hmm. And then there, but there's also something about it struggling to suppress every part of that also.
Because you can see the real person starting to get out. And there's not, it's one of my favorite things to see a person do is just all the facial changes they'll go into.
So many emotions at once.
Yeah.
So clearly expressed.
Yeah, and then there's that hard push back into a grin that I went, oh, okay, that's good. With the sheer, her choice to do a slow... Yeah. Like, change of that instead of a quick, like, regroup, to me is a better shot, a better image.
Because it's a, that's it them shows the struggle.
Pushing it back.
Yeah, yeah.
And the grin is, the grin is them pushing it all down. Oh, it's so good. Such good acting in this movie. Good, man. So the phone, so that scene's...
The phone,
Oh, and also we haven't talked about the art dealer.
The blind man.
The one person you think in the party is gonna...
Who's cool.
Who's reasonable.
Yeah.
Human being. And, but he, and he's a blind person, so he doesn't see color.
He can't see color. Yeah.
So he's just a cool guy.
Yeah.
Who turns out to want...
I mean...
But he doesn't want it for the racial reason.
So we have to talk about this.
Okay, we have to talk about this.
So later on, when they meet up for the second time in the film, and you get it spelled out for you that I'm gonna take your body. They're gonna scoop out 95% of your brain.
Yeah.
There's gonna be
some weird spinal thing that changes,
There's gonna be a little piece of you left that's just gonna be lint floating around in your body while I pilot it. And then he makes that clear. He's like, it's not a racial thing. It's not because...
Well, because he asks, because the main character
Why black?
He's not the one that brings up.
Yeah.
Which is very important. He's why black? He's like,
I don't care.
Some people like want that as a weird sex thing, or like for
physical
prowess.
Prowess. Yeah.
I just want your eyes.
Yeah.
Which that's still a weird relation because it's like our eyes will really choose the better photography,
right?
Because that's his reasoning is that he was never a good photographer. That's why he became an art dealer.
So he just wanted a body to be in.
Yeah.
Yeah. But the thing is,
well, he wants to see again.
Wants to see again. Yeah. So,
and in his head, choosing a photographer and artist probably like, would help fulfill him in some way
as being a successful, because he explains,
because he views it as a genetic thing, not as like a mental capacity.
But so, like, I thought it was interesting to talk about, like, just because you yourself don't think of yourself as being racist, doesn't mean you don't benefit from racism or people who are racist.
No, of course.
That's how I...
He's obviously benefiting from this.
He's benefiting massively from people who are shitty racists.
Yeah.
So, like, that's one of the things that I thought was, again, a very nuanced thing to talk about. Mm-hmm. Like, well, I'm not mean to black people. Mm-hmm. I don't talk down to...
I benefit
from the fact that black people get treated like shit.
Yeah.
And I'm not gonna change that, because, like, I like getting all the neat stuff I get. So, like, that as a...
It's another nuance.
It's another flavor in the soup. And it's delightful. It's delightful, sir. Oh, fuck.
Okay, so the garden party is going on. And he goes upstairs, which, again, is probably one of my favorite scenes. Although I like the maid scene a lot. I like her acting. So, I think they move on to... Oh, no, that's when they throw in another, the biggest red herring for the girlfriend, when they're by the lake, and he's like, "I want to."
And she offers,
"This shit's weird."
Yeah.
And she offers him, like any reasonable person, which I also think is a play on the horror movie trope, is her going, "Let's just go."
Yeah.
Why not? Well, let's just leave. Not, let's just play it out and see what happens, and because it's not gonna answer, let's go right now.
Yeah.
Because in any other horror movie, it would be It's not as bad as you think it is. It's just play it out and then wait for us to get killed.
It's or something. Honey, I've been with you this long. Yeah. I trust that you don't feel safe.
Yeah, I know you are obviously uncomfortable.
Yeah,
like let's go. That is, and it's one of the most reasonable things, and it's the most reasonable thing for her, the only anchor you have in the movie. Yeah.
Oh God damn it! Then, we have to talk.
Yeah. We're getting there. Because a lot of the big, like, twist in the movie happened like pretty much at the end, and
within
like,
the last 20 minutes,
it's more of like a nice exponential curve into tension.
Yeah.
Just how I usually like it.
But we at the beginning we have a step. Are you going to talk about the closet?
Yeah, well, we're going to get there as like they're leaving.
Okay, go ahead.
Well, because I think that's it, right? Like, there's the auction.
There's the auction with the bingo cards, yeah.
Which is just harkening back to slavery.
Actual slavery, straight up slavery.
Yeah.
But I was going to say then, because at the beginning we establish, very early, like the first scene, she says, he says, is it a problem that I'm black? I've never had a black boyfriend, but it won't be a problem.
Yeah.
So that's established, I've never had a black boyfriend, is out and out said. And I think maybe the parents reiterate it. And then they're packing up, getting ready to go. She's making the excuse so they can leave. Mm-hmm. And then he opens the little cupboard. And then there's a little box inside.
Just photos of all the black guy.
Photos.
And the bi relationship.
Yeah.
Which is the grandmother.
Yeah.
Because she's obviously just a hired, like, almost hitman.
Yeah.
Or, like, hitwoman of just trying to drag people in there.
She seduces...
Yeah.
Mostly men, but at least one woman.
Yeah.
In. Yeah.
At least one, obviously.
Yeah. And then his fear and containing that as soon as she's right. But, oh, my God.
Yeah. It's so good.
Fuck. And then, can I say, it's very weird to me, so I'm skipping it. So they go to the stairs.
Okay.
The parents are there.
Yeah.
The door is blocked. Uh-huh. Also, the lacrosse stick is a weird detail, but...
Yeah, and they bring it back.
Yeah.
Like, later, because he beats him over the head with it.
Yeah.
That's cool.
But, and then you have that scene wherein she's taking fucking forever, and you just think, well, this also falls into horror tropes. Just fucking pull them out. I can hear them in your purse.
Yeah.
And then her line, that fucking... It's both despair and anger.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but like that was my gut reaction was fear. I felt furious.
Yeah.
And just, oh no, no.
The one anchor you had in the movie.
The one anchor, as it turns out, you can't trust anyone.
Yeah, no, everyone. No.
Everyone is out to get you.
Yeah.
Every single person is out to get you.
Oh, and then, she goes her.
Yeah.
And then that's where they go into the whole weird... thing. That's where you find out it's a cult, which playing back with the whole cult thing in horror movies.
Yeah.
And then just the whole fetishization
of black bodies.
Yeah.
By one old scientist who is like, well, the only reason I didn't get in was because I wasn't black.
Yeah.
So I'm going to take that one way that black people are better, and I'm going to give it to people by stealing it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, we haven't talked about Chris, his friend, Chris.
Yes, we haven't. Oh, okay. Yeah. So, again, just actually real solid comedy.
The only comedy! Yeah, the only comedy.
But it's good.
It's great.
It's a great, like, relief to it. The whole, it's a sex thing. Like,
they're fucking black people. They're making them sex slaves, you know?
Yeah, it's Mice Wide Shut going on.
Just it's just very much Key and Peele, like, level of skits.
Of deconstructing and, like...
Yeah.
He's clearly seen horror films, and he knows what's good.
It's that character in the movie that's, who knows the tropes.
Yeah.
And he goes for him and everything.
I told you not to go in the house.
I told you not to go in the house.
That's such a Key and Peele moment. Oh, and we'll get to that, because I think that last scene's genius.
It's brilliant.
There's a lot of things going on that I think that last, like, scene of that movie is fucking great.
But to have him, like, do even basic research, and then set him up as a TSA agent.
Yeah.
And he does research and finds out, oh, that was a jazz musician who we missed 6 months ago.
That was a guy they knew.
Yeah. Shelley's cousin.
Somewhere. Which I don't know if I... Not sure if that's just for plot reasons or if it is supposed to play off the thing of, like, every black person
knows each other. I think that's kind of making a joke about it.
Yeah.
Was that the guy in the beginning?
Because Ant-Man...
Was that the guy in the beginning?
I think that's the guy in the beginning.
That's the guy in the
beginning. Because the reason I think that, too, is they show the mask again.
When he steals the car.
The only other time you see the mask.
It's in the back of that white car. Yeah.
Which, again, that's playing on that trope that there's a mask killer, like... Doing everything.
Yeah.
But you only see it in the back of the car because They stole the money.
But also that guy in the mask does the exact same headlock thing as the brother. So
as that, the brother.
Yeah.
So who was established to be an MMA fighter. So the surgery going, by the way, and like this is the first, because usually in most horror films or most films in general, the hero, in order for them to murder someone, they have to be justified pretty close to the murder, like as in self-defense.
Right, yeah.
Or shooting them. But he just, the fact that he's the one that attacks first, and it's like the most justified.
Oh, no one for a second.
No one's going to question this guy. He's a hero for doing this.
He deer rams that fucking guy.
So fucking brutal. Like, it's awesome.
Burns that shit. Fuck! I was so like the
amount. Make sure to make sure to burn it.
Yeah, like, make sure to burn. Did your audience clap? My audience fucking clapped.
Yeah, we fucking clapped.
Everyone was clapping.
Yeah, everyone was clapping.
Because it was, again, it was the most justified
thing
ever.
Totally.
Then beats him over the head with the Massimo.
The crosshair.
Super brutal. Yeah, they're all like really brutal deaths too.
Harsh.
Like, everyone gets it hard.
I felt like, and then you feel that tension for the minute where the teacup is on the on the table and they
but both immediately get that shit out of the way so it becomes a knife fight.
Yeah.
But then it's he fucking catches,
he pushes like, through a knife through the palm.
Like a like a superhero.
Yeah.
And, like, turns it to stab into her face.
Ugh, it was amazing.
It's fucking brutal.
Oh,
just real satisfying. Yeah. Beautiful. Like,
to be fair. They deserved it.
They had
the whole thing.
Yeah, they had it coming, man.
That's why you feel justified.
And then that periodic cut to the girlfriend upstairs eating Fruit Loops.
Yeah,
and just looking through black photos of black men.
Uh-huh.
I don't know. Tell me what you think about this. I kind of on it. I thought it was an okay. He was the person I saw the movie with was like. I think that's a metaphor for separating colors and whites.
I think the Fruit Loops
are in a bowl and the
because someone else actually pointed that out on the podcast that like they're like like maybe it is. And it could also be a thing of they're not trying to whitewash a black person.
Yeah.
They're just they know they're different and they want that.
Yeah.
So it's that difference.
That's so it's kind of like in an extreme
with so much details I wouldn't put him past like Peele at this point.
Yeah. So I guess you can say it's kind of like one of the most extreme forms of like idolization.
Yeah.
It's so idolizing you become, you know, like you see horror movies, like it's against.
Oh yeah, they idolize them so much she's actually into them.
Like, and you know,
it's a weird fetish thing.
You know, like in horror movies, like I love you so much, I'm gonna cut your face off and be you. So
yeah.
Kind of like that, right?
It is. I guess you could compare. Could compare it to that. I love you so much, I have to peel your skin off and put it on me.
Yeah.
But
well, it's also that thing of like I'm only in this relationship with you. Because you're black, or you're Hispanic, or you're like the specific type of color. That's always weird to me.
That's super gross. Yeah.
I mean, you can. I mean, there's such things as types with people,
but
when it comes to like baggage, and you expect them to act a certain way,
yes,
because that's what you want. Yeah. That's a problem. Well, that's a big fucking problem.
Or when you hit up with people that are like, oh, I only date Asian guys, or I only date
because because there's that expectation of them, they have to act a certain way.
So clearly, there's more going on. I'll never touch that. Like,
because that's always like a fear for me. I've always hated. That's my most hated thing with a lot of racism, at least that I personally come in contact with, is like the idea of you don't act your race enough.
Yeah, you need to be more this.
Yeah, let's be real. How many people listening to this who don't know us personally assume we're Hispanic?
Sure.
I mean, I don't think I've ever spoken Spanish on here. I don't think
no.
And my voice is not at all like the stereotypical
what one expects. We are
going ASN. This is what I think of Nier Automata.
They're pretty
homes,
it's not that stereotype
pretty
thing,
bland right? American accents.
Like, and I hate that. I fucking hate when people like expect you to act like
That's
like
not...
like the fact that your race has to be the state of mind, as someone it's Wooly who put it in a podcast, that black is a state of mind that's the phrase, or that any race is like a state of mind, that's where it comes from.
Absolutely.
It's like how Well, it's the whole thing with, like, the tension between, like, white rappers and, like, the black rappers. Is it just the same line or something like that?
Absolutely. Well, if I recall, with that argument, it was, like, I was listening to Sirius Radio, an interview with A$AP Rock from Beastie Boys.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And it was basically an interview, because...
Which he's a huge nerd, but, like...
Absolutely. Sirius Radio, he was basically talking about... Because an intern, after the interview on Sirius Radio, interns from the station came up and asked him questions.
Oh, okay.
And literally one of the first questions was, like an early 20-year-old woman who asked him, oh, was it like being your group, being white in hip-hop in a stage where hip-hop was still developing?
Right, right, right.
And he even talked about, well, yes, he said that the biggest difference was that it's not as popularized as it is now. There was an expectation because it was still developing.
Right.
And given that, you know, he said, like, you know, the internet wasn't there, so it wasn't easy to connect people to tell, you know, what's up.
Yeah, that's why they hated their audience for, like...
Because they all love the one joke song.
Yeah.
So...
And they took it as real. So
yeah. And he did say in some cities, a lot of rappers were worried that they were just trying to mock. It was, like, out of mockery. But... They clearly, A$AP Rock explained that his friends and hit producers, they did what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
And clearly that was expressed through the other rappers, and they, you know, they're now legends. Like, they're now the legends, one of the standards.
Well, it's obviously their own style. It's not them pretending to be anyone else.
They're trying to be themselves. They're doing things their way.
There's a reason we have rappers who are, like, kids that we just consider Beastie Boy, like, copy hacks.
So I guess it's kind of like that, like, you know, the whole, like, it's kind of like when you idolize someone, you try to be them, and when you be them, you're not you.
Exactly.
Yeah. So it's kind of like the whole
it's the whole thing. It's that the race or the particular thing is a state of mind.
Yeah.
Not exactly. Actually being.
Exactly. And not only are you not being you, you're kind of stealing something from them by doing it. That's one thing I was thinking about through when I figured out when you find out what's going on.
Yeah.
I thought a lot about the idea of, like, stealing people's culture and trying to make it your own.
Yeah.
White people dreads is the main idea, but
there are other things. What's that term for making cities into?
Oh, gentrification.
Gentrification, where you're taking the poor things because. Hipsters want.
Yeah, exactly.
Poor
exactly.
things are like this certain aspect of a city,
but, and it's the
but thing make that, it fit for them.
Exactly. Yeah. It's not. It's instead of saying, "Oh, that's really cool. I want to respect that and help your community do that because that's cool and be involved in it."
Uh-huh.
It's saying, "But let me make it cool for me, and so without you involved."
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's the actual, like, stealing someone's identity. It's the metaphorical putting your brain inside of a black person's body.
What were you gonna say?
Well, no, I was gonna say, like, the whole, well, I remember the whole dreadlocks thing. I did talk to someone about that. I think it was early college.
Yeah.
And I, well, basically explained, because, like, it's the whole thing of, like, well, I mean, if you have long hair, it's inevitably, if you don't, you know, wash it, it's gonna clump up.
Yeah.
It's disgusting, no matter who it is. Like, it smells bad.
Well, no, there's also this form of dreads where they actually...
You put,
like,
oil in it.
Yeah, yeah, there's a certain thing you do.
Take care of it, yeah.
I used to know a guy who, like, he told me the whole process behind that.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty nuts.
For that specific
kind of dreads.
Yeah.
But no, you're usually right.
I told the person, he's like, no, they're trying to steal shit. I'm like, no, they're not trying to steal. He just hasn't washed his fucking hair.
He's just gross. Yeah, he's just disgusting.
He's just a gross man. And that's something everyone can relate to. I stood up in the class like, gee, everyone can relate to.
Man, woman, child.
Like Morgan Freeman. There was a time that dreadlocks were appropriate. I'm just kidding.
Appropriate for every man, woman, and child.
But, I was going to say, that's why I really liked the movie, because it did the whole, like, extreme idolization like, the most extreme. So I did think that was interesting.
That's fascinating. It is fascinating. So I just wanted to talk about the Skinwalker thing before we talk about the very last part of the movie.
Okay. So. Yeah, because that last scene is, like, fucking thing is awesome.
Yeah. I didn't want to break that. I wanted to go in one chunk. He escapes, burns down the house, and then he steals the car that we understand the brother to own, because it has the same mask in it.
That's what's, to be presumed.
And he hits the grandma with a car?
It looks like she just jumps onto it.
Yeah.
And then he has that moment where he goes, I know this is stupid, just leave her. It's fucking dumb. But we've already established the whole mother thing.
Yeah.
So it's perfectly reasonable why he would bring her. Like, I think it's reasonable. It's still definitely the wrong thing.
And then he knows it. He knows this is really dumb.
But that mother thing is so internalized in him.
And that it's so hard. And that over the last 2 days, it has clearly been wrenched up out of him.
Yeah, yeah. A lot. It's obviously prevalent in his mind, so it makes that whole thing justifiable.
Yeah,
yeah.
She goes fucking bananas.
Yeah.
Gets in a car crash. Smashes.
That's where you find out she's the grandmother.
She's the grandmother. You ruined my house.
Yeah.
Smashes that shit up. He walks away from that because he was the only one in the seatbelt.
Yes.
Boys and girls.
And... I didn't even notice that. Yeah, that's right, yeah. He gets out,
he's fine, and then his fucking crazy ex-girlfriend comes out with a shotgun.
Yeah, well, she was shooting at him with, like, a rifle, like...
Well, rifle. A hunting rifle. Like one would kill a deer with.
Okay.
That's probably nothing.
And then the grandfather, who's the groundskeeper, like, Usain bolts up on top of him. And then, because we've learned earlier, he can undo the trance with...
With a flash.
Flash.
Yeah.
And he then takes the gun, fucks up that girl.
Fucking gut shots her, like, point blank.
And then he caps himself off.
Yeah.
Just straight through the head.
And there, what do you think was going through his head? Because I have my own theory.
I don't want to live like this anymore.
Yeah, that's part of my reasoning. I think my also fear was that he didn't know whether or not it would come back. Because he saw the jazz musician basically come back from it. He didn't want a chance of that.
Yeah, that's my feeling, too. Like, he knew he didn't want to go back if there was any hint at all.
Did you feel like that was what the grandmother did the first time where she jumps out at the car?
No, because I don't... Because there was no flash beforehand, and there's no thing of her turning.
Sure.
You only get that one scene where you're tearing up, but she gets back to normal.
Yeah, she squashes that. Normal quotation.
I think it's the grandmother just being desperate and, like...
Trying to make a last
ditch effort. Her. Mm-hmm.
And then... She didn't die.
Yeah. So, he crawls up on top of her and starts choking her out.
Choking this bitch, and then she
and
tries...
And then the fucking cop lights start going on.
Wait. Reel back.
Okay.
2 minutes. Sorry.
Two minutes? Okay.
Oh, boy.
She then tries to say, you know, we had a sweet thing together, don't do this to me. And then he powers through that shit. Fuck you. Then the cop lights come. The
cop lights come on. And immediately, what's going on? Her face.
Just this.
Oh my god, we forgot my scene. Okay, well, yeah, let's finish talking about it. Yeah, we'll come back to it. But yeah, her face up going, yes, I like.
She's just so fucking happy.
Yeah.
She's so pleased with herself.
And then Chris's face of just
being destroyed.
No. Yeah. He knows, and he already puts his
hands up.
He knows
there's
exactly
a streak of blood everywhere. Yeah. All
people
over
in the theater where I was watching automatically
gasped.
Went, oh no.
Yeah.
Like, yeah.
Yeah.
Because you know what that is, especially in this day and age of racial tension and what
that
become associated
with.
We're given that thing. That's the biggest, quickest red herring in the entire movie.
Did you think about, I thought of Night of the Living Dead. It made me think about that right away.
I can see that. Especially with the burning house, like, in the
background. House in the background,
And then you gotta remember, the only other cop car we've seen in this movie is the police officers.
That's
so
true.
So, of course, we would have that image in our head as well, because we think it's them. But it's the
TSA. It's the TSA fucking guy!
Who saves the day in this horror movie? The comic relief. Usually the first... The funny black guy
first
who's
to die.
The first to die
in
every other, like, stereotypical horror movie is the savior, that comes by and helps his friend. And I think that moment is so fucking powerful, especially with the cop lights going off like that. I think it's genius.
And how fucking, I loved how destroyed she looked.
Yeah.
She was just like, fuck.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Oh, it's so satisfying.
Oh, my God.
And he just leaves her to die.
Leave
to bleed out.
Yeah, leave her out there.
She's gutshot. She was half choked to death.
Her family's dead. The house is on fire.
There's nothing. She's going to die within a couple minutes.
Yeah.
Like,
Yeah.
Fuck her.
Yeah.
And then
the last line is, I told you.
You shouldn't have fucking gone in that house.
Oh, I thought it was, how'd you find me?
Yeah.
I am
T.S. motherfucking A. We handle our shit.
Again, one of the most Key and Peele moments. And it's, dude, I love that scene because there's so many layers going on, not just with Ray. Like, of course, there's that racial thing, but there's also the racial thing in horror movies. And, like,
yeah.
Again, the black comic relief is the savior of this movie. He's not the fodder in the beginning.
The hero.
Yeah.
In many ways. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, there's so much going on.
And he's doing it from his end, from only knowing, like, certain things. He makes the connections.
Yeah.
Like, of course, he still thinks it's a whole sex thing.
He does think
it's a sex thing. It's enough for him to go off and know this is bad. Yeah. It's genius. It's so good.
It's really, like, good, man.
That movie's so well thought out, well put together.
Yeah.
Oh, it's great. And again, we didn't talk about my favorite piece of acting in this film, is when he calls the girlfriend earlier that night.
Fuck!
She's talking, she's giving him the thing. And in fact, you're seeing it from his side, so you're assuming she's just pretending to be this. But her her face is this dead, blank, no acting, and yet she can get all those cadences, all those different, from sarcasm to, like, this...
to this accusatory thing.
Accusatory to this kind of, like, seductiveness, all without showing your voice. I know that that with CG you could fake that. With her VR thing. I'm going to choose to believe that's real.
That was real.
Because that acting was so fucking amazing to me. I think that acting is inspiring. Yeah. As someone who wanted to be, like, a voice actor as a kid, like, that's the ultimate.
Yeah.
Mastering your voice.
Yeah.
Kudos to that actress. I wish I remembered her name at this moment. Because I think that is some of the best acting I've seen in a long time.
Yeah, I love the conversation when he started talking back to her.
Because
what she was doing, clearly, like, she's trained, so she's been doing it before.
She's done this before.
Yeah. And this is her, like, getting advantage over
him. And it's, like, throwing him off. I was like, what? No, bitch, I'm not doing
that. I'm actually not into
that. And he holds it. Oh, God, she's a genius.
That's great.
Oh, fuck, man.
It's such a good movie.
It's really great, it's man. So good.
I really like it.
I think it's genius. And the more you look into it, like, the more you realize how much these
little specific... You can peel away little pieces.
Yeah.
The other thing about... We mentioned a little bit about the... I'm sorry we're going so long, man, but...
It's fine.
It's cool.
I get to talk about Get Out. So, like...
You have, like, three or four, like, a lot of scenes where Chris says something to his girlfriend, and she kind of, like, does a joke and to dismiss it. And it's not like, and it doesn't come off as, oh, what a bitch.
Yeah.
But, like, when it adds up that she just repeatedly is like, oh, is that really what's gonna happen?
Yeah.
Is that, like, can you take, like, my feelings seriously for even one fucking minute? Like,
yeah.
Well, and that's what makes that lakeside scene work. Yeah. Is because she hasn't been really doing that.
Yeah.
And so the one give she gives to him, he's ready to grab hold of
it. Yeah, yeah.
But it's already too late.
It's way too late. Yeah. Oh, man.
That movie's good. Okay, are we done talking about it so I can give the hard time stamp for it?
One last thing. I was watching Jordan Peele getting interviewed about Get Out and his writing it. And apparently, so when he was talking about he's got a few other projects like this, he also hinted at, I don't know if this is going to turn people on or off. I hope it turns you on, because it turned me on. I'm rigid. he said that he wants to have it possibly in a contained reality.
Okay.
So that, not necessarily crossover, but that it would be in a shared continuity.
So, like, because I can see that, especially with the cult. Like, thing being real. If there's, like, little hints, I wouldn't want the exact same.
And also, what the fuck happens to the jazz singer?
Yeah.
That's a loose thread.
There's a whole big cult out there.
Yeah.
That we know of.
Yeah.
So that's already enough.
Yeah.
To establish that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So yeah, no, I can't wait to see what he comes up with next, because this was obviously genius. Like, it was so good.
Yeah.
All right. So are we good?
Good.
Okay, our timestamp is now, Future Chris. And we're back. Wow. How long were you talking about that shit? For a while. Holy crap, that's like...
Wow. It's a good movie.
That's almost a whole hour. Like, oh, shit.
Just that. You could just package that shit off as its own thing.
As its own little side thing, right?
Yeah, movie's all right.
Okay, so, yeah, what do you guys have coming up? What are you guys looking forward to? Any projects you're working on? Do you want to shill onto here? Or yeah, and what are you looking forward to?
What am I looking forward to? I'm looking forward to the next few episodes of Samurai Jack. I think it's going to be very exciting.
Yeah, I can't fucking wait. This Saturday? Shit, we are going to miss it this Saturday, though, because we do have a concert that me and Nick are going to.
Oh, okay.
To really timestamp this hard. Carbonite Brut and Dance with the Dead are going to be in concert. Mm-hmm. Okay. I've been looking forward to this show for a fucking while.
Yeah, same.
And to relate it to Samurai Jack, Carbonite Brut did the music for the trailers for Samurai Jack.
Really?
Those are his synth-like stuff going on.
Very cool.
Yeah. Have you seen the trailer?
Yeah, I've seen it.
So that's snippets of his songs.
Yeah. Samurai Jack.
Samurai Jack, I am looking forward to... several movies. I don't know. I don't have them all on a list.
Yeah.
Are you
gonna watch Kong, or have you seen Kong? Or does that interest you?
I'm gonna watch it, but I'm probably not gonna see it in a movie theater.
Okay. Sorry. Fair enough.
I will watch it though.
I'll get to talk about giant monsters.
I feel the same way about Godzilla. I wanted to see it, but I watched it when it came out later.
That's a shame. I think some shots were like so well done that I felt like a big screen benefited. But hey.
Those are the main tickets. I am doing a project right now that is Corsair-esque, but okay. I can't say what it is or anything about it.
Well, you said kind of on the last podcast, I think, that is coming back in some way, shape, or form.
It's coming back in a way, shape, or form, so...
And the obvious question everyone is wondering is do we have a job? You know, like,
we'll see. So if you...
Hey, man, I could do the video editing, I could do the podcast editing in case they decide to do something.
Yeah, I'm here.
The only thing I would say to the listeners who are interested in Corsair-based things is keep an eye on my social media.
What's your Instagram?
My Instagram is The Modern Corsair on Instagram. And you can find me on basically any other platform. I'm The Modern Corsair.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is all one word or is it?
It is all one word, all lowercase.
And I've been putting it wrong.
It's okay.
I'm putting an underdash between Modern and Corsair.
Is it?
Oh, yeah, you want to check?
You know what? Maybe I should double check.
Because I remember that's what you sent me.
I'll double check it right. I'm sure.
Anything else you're looking for?
If that's what I. What else am I looking forward to? Oh, you know what? I am looking forward to very much is. There's going to be a re-release on DVD of the first two Texas Chainsaw Massacres.
Really?
I did not know that.
Maybe I will buy that too.
It is on Instagram. I am modern_Corsair.
Oh, yeah, fuck you. I've been typing it right.
He remembers it more than I do. I'm very excited. Not a lot of people liked Chainsaw 2. Because it's silly and weird.
Yeah, it's really... It's such a big departure from, like, the first
very one. Different film.
Honestly, with the first movie, I think all you really need to see is just the family dinner.
Where they keep... Grandpa can't fucking hold it worth his life.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty good
scene. That whole scene. That's pretty good. I think it's one of the best in any horror. Like,
it's upsetting.
And sadly, the only way they were able to do it is because it was real, and they were all hallucinating due to, like, heat stroke.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah,
man.
I mean, that scene where Leatherface is out there swinging he actually almost hit Toby Hooper with a chainsaw. Wow. What about you, Nick?
What about you, Nick? What are you looking forward to?
Again, Samurai Jack. I'm looking forward. I do have some music projects with some friends working on. I was able to establish...
Can you say what those music projects are at this moment, or is it still under wraps? Because there's project... I mean... We have to assume we're always working on something that we just can't talk about at the moment. So,
yeah. I guess one I could reveal is that I'm still working on developing a game for a composition.
Oh, very cool.
Oh, wow. So you're just going to announce that?
Yeah, I got contracted for a composition.
Okay. I didn't know what stage of development you guys were in that you could, like, say shit about it. So
that's pretty cool, man. I should have more information next
podcast is still in development.
Okay, that's yeah. Great, yeah, you can advertise that shit on here.
Yeah.
You can find me on You can find me now on Twitter as Moonsault Sound.
Yeah. That's so far up your own ass.
Isn't it great?
Yeah, nice combination of wrestling and like yeah. and sound. That's pretty good.
Yeah, thank you. And then besides that, I would like to catch up. I'm gonna look forward to catching up on Jessica Jones since I'm halfway through it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, sadly I think Jessica Jones is one of those things where it could have ended a little bit earlier. Like there was some fluff towards the end.
Yeah.
After they had cut it, I think it could have. By the way, I think Iron Fist has that problem big time.
Fluff?
I kept feeling like, okay, now the series is ended. Like, there was literally a thing where I went, oh, shit, there's a whole nother episode.
Oh, wow.
Okay. And I went, oh, this seemed like such a tight fitting end.
Right, yeah.
Or at least, it wasn't a tight fitting end, at least this was enough to end it.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe there was a whole nother episode, like, honestly.
Yeah.
It's so weird. That, it just keeps going, like, from, oh, sorry, go ahead. Yeah, Jessica Jones.
You liking it?
Yeah, no, I really like it so far. It's really,
it's different from Daredevil.
Very different. Yeah. Very different.
Lower budget, too, but it's, they don't really need it.
They make it work, I think.
Yeah, because it's mainly just really good acting and writing.
Also. Yeah, I really like the writing. I really like the characters. Mm-hmm. I think some of them I like a little bit more than in Daredevil, but it's vice versa as well. There's some I do like in Daredevil more than, like, again, Kingpin.
Yeah. Well, because they're both really good series.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, yeah.
I think you got to watch Luke Cage and then you go to Iron Fist.
Yeah. If you gotta watch Iron Fist, I guess.
Yeah. I know. I mean, I would watch it just so when the Defenders come out.
Right.
For sure. I mean, that's gonna... You gotta know for that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's about it.
Yeah, it's a real disappointment. Yeah, right on. So for me, there's a lot of stuff now that I'm finally... school has slowed down.
Mm-hmm.
Lucha Underground. On Netflix. I watched the first episode. That fight between Johnny Mundo and Prince Puma is so fucking awesome and one of the best wrestling choreographed fights I've seen in a long ass time. Mm-hmm. I cannot wait to keep going with Lucha Underground. And I know shit, shit that happens. There's death tournaments, there's kumites, there's like fucking kamidogus.
It gets better.
I know. Everyone tells me. It gets
better.
Oh, I can't wait. I'm like, it's everything I've ever wanted fixed in wrestling.
Yeah. Oh my God.
And it's there.
I can't wait for you to get to the
Someone did it for me, and I'm like, I'm waiting. I can't wait.
I can't wait for you to get to the coffin match.
I know! People keep telling me about the fucking coffin match. I don't even know what that means. I'm silly for it. Do you know about Lucha Underground?
I don't know about it, but I'm going to watch it now.
Okay. It's Robert Rodriguez's TV show on just luchador wrestling. The way they do it, instead of the WWE, where they have basically three shows every week, and the writing has basically been shit for, like, so long, and some of the... There's still good wrestlers. I'm pointing out to, like, Brendan Williams, the Great Black Otagu, and Xavier Woods, I think. With New Day. I like their whole gimmick. I really do. These guys, since they do it in seasons, they're able to actually write an overarching story with everything. Like, and all the fights are super well choreographed and well done. Here's how I was sold on the thing, okay? Because there's a scene in there where someone just enters a ring. This is his character. Mm-hmm. This is how they establish his character. Okay. He enters a ring. He just stands there. And then the lights go out in the entire stadium. Then they come back on. And then there's three separate wrestlers all running around going nuts in the middle of the ring. And then the lights turn back off in like this weird magic thing. Then they come back on and it's just that one wrestler standing in there again. Implying that his power is the ability to split into three separate wrestlers in the story. Then I went, oh, they're doing it. They're putting magic in the shit.
I'm into this.
First two seasons are on Netflix now. I'm so, now that I've, because Love was on the back burner because I really wanted to know what happened. Iron Fist, because I was really excited.
I was.
But now Lucha Underground, dude, I can't wait to fucking dive in. I'm like, oh, I've been waiting so long for this. So what else? Nier Automata, of course I'm playing through, I can't wait. I already got one ending. For anyone who's played it, it's the macro ending.
Okay.
I won't even spoil it because I just think that ending was genius. Mm-hmm. Like, hey, I saw credits. Technically, I beat the game. So, Nier Automata. And, oh shit, this will be coming out the 31st. So I will have announced it at this time. But our YouTube, I'm going to be starting a stream for Twitch.
Okay.
On our YouTube channel, Man Charisma Leonai. I haven't established a date as of right now. By the time this comes out, I probably would have, because I still have to talk it out with Matt. What the days are.
Mm.
But we're going to be doing... I'm going to be doing it. I've already spoken to Henry. I've already spoken to Nick. We're going to for sure be doing it for Persona 5.
Oh, cool.
So it'll be in time for that. We're going to probably do the first 6 hours.
Okay.
Probably not going to do the entire game, because that's probably going to be 200 hours.
Mm-hmm.
So that's some commitments.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I want to do a regular weekly stream thing. So far, it's looking to be Saturdays. But again, by the time this episode has come out, I've probably already put up a video.
Okay.
Telling what the days are. So yeah, that's going to be coming out. That's probably going to be at Matt and Chris Play All Night for Twitch. What else? I mean, Kong, I'm going to watch tomorrow, and I'm probably going to talk about a lot, and I hope it's good. Go Mango Podcast when I'm on for them to talk about the Power Rangers movie, because we're all misfits here, folks. Indeed. And I'll probably watch Logan. There's a lot of shit now that I have free time.
Yeah.
So yeah, Persona 5. I want to get Yakuza 0, because I've already been borrowing a friend's game to play, and I'm already at like 8 hours in, and I've been doing nothing but side missions. That game's fucking fantastic. That game's so good. It'd have to be Yakuza 5. If someone beat Yakuza 5, one day we should just have me just talk the entire time about Yakuza game, and it should be the same incomprehensible, non-cohesive way I've been talking about it, where it's just shit that happens.
It sounds crazy. Because it is.
It is, and it's amazing.
It would be, what would make that more fun is if at the end of the episode, you're like, well, I want to thank all the viewers for me, and, oh shit, they're not even here.
But what? What kind of weird, is this thing on?
I've been talking in a room by myself.
I've been talking to a wall since I heard, with a cardboard that says microphone on it.
And then we have a voice actor, like, it's lights out, stop talking in there!
I have to go find out if what she was doing is real. Because if so, it's some of the best acting I've seen.
I think it's genuinely real. I think
it was genuinely real. I really do hope so.
I think it's real.
Oh my god, I have to keep listening to Tanis. Did you start listening to Rabbits?
No, I haven't started Rabbits or Tanis. I'm closing up a bunch of other podcasts I've been on.
Okay, so I'm on... So I'm fully caught up with both.
Okay.
Rabbits is pretty good. It's really good.
It's more... I got... Just tell me if yes or no.
Okay.
I got the impression that it's like an ARG kind of situation.
It's all about ARGs.
It's all about ARGs?
Yeah. Okay. Or about a very specific one.
Okay. Okay.
In fact, they spend the majority of the first episode talking about, like, ARGs.
Oh, tight. Okay.
Hold on. So...
Because I've been listening to a lot of the Welcome to Nightvale collection podcasts. Uh-huh. Like, the company... branched out and they're having other artists come in. So I've been listening to Alice Isn't Dead, which I finished.
Yeah.
I
still have to listen to Alice.
I'm
so far behind on Night Vale shit, dude.
It's really good. I love it. I know. I've just caught up on Night Vale. I'm caught up on... I've finished all of season one of Within the Wires, which was weirdly intense.
Yeah.
If you like medical horror...
Yeah.
And... I don't know. It's really good. I don't want to tell you anything else about it. And now I'm almost done with the singer from Neutral Milk Hotel wrote a podcast for them called The Human Circus of the Air, about a show that broadcasts from the top of the Eiffel Tower.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'm almost caught up with that. It's very weird. There's like a bird that plays the orchestra and crickets tell stories. It's a very good show. It's very strange.
Okay. Yeah.
But once I'm done, I'm going to catch up with Tanis and then I'll do Rabbits.
Okay.
Whichever
okay.
order. One or the other.
Yeah. God, dude, I wish Tanis was weekly. I know they have to get stuff bi-weekly.
The episodes are getting longer, aren't they?
They're getting a little bit longer. They one hit 50 minutes, and that's long.
I'm not saying there's a complaint either.
No, I'm not gleeful.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
No, if anything, I would want
hours.
I wouldn't even mind if I just got hours of just him talking about shit. Like, It's like the best friend cast. I love it when they do a super long one because they're just talking about dumb shit like the entire time.
Yeah.
Rabbits, I think, is weekly.
Rabbits is weekly?
I believe so. I'm going to double check that because I remember getting it last week and I went, wait, isn't this whatever? Like,
what's the story on Black Tapes? Is that coming back soon?
I have no clue. Black. I've been trying to find out too.
Well, actually, this month is Tripod. If you're familiar, have you been hearing about this?
What's that?
Tripod is, I don't have a brief in front of me. Tripod is actually an arrangement made upon a series of broadcasters who make podcasts.
Okay.
Wherein podcasts at the end of every podcast broadcast in this month try and recommend good podcasts you should be listening to.
Oh, well, I guess we've been doing that already in the spirit of it, right?
In so the like, spirit of that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so if we're going to recommend a podcast real quick, we obviously those. Okay, just choose one, then you guys. All right?
Got one.
I'm not going to say the super friend, best friend cast because I feel like I always talk about that all the time.
Sure.
Or Tannis or Rabbits and Black Tapes because
we talk about that all the time.
There's this one I want to get back onto called the Lore Podcast, which I think was mentioned by Tannis. It's really good. Every episode is about like 15 minutes long, but it just goes into origins of very specific supernatural stories, vampires, werewolves, like even gnomes, and like where they come from. So I'd recommend that one.
Yeah. I would recommend Hello Internet with CGP Grey and the guy from Numberphile. I keep forgetting his name.
Okay.
It's is always great, and Cortex is another one. But Cortex is more it's more about technology. While Hello Internet, it's more about basically their channel and kind of just whatever they feel like talking about. It's really interesting.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm gonna recommend Homecoming, which is
I've heard that name.
It's a 6-part series made by Gimlet, and it's got Oscar Isaac, the guy who played Ross on Friends. Amy Sedaris is in it.
Wow.
It's got a great cast.
Yeah.
It's about PTSD in soldiers.
Okay.
And secret government actions taken on those soldiers. Okay. It's a very good series. It's only 6 episodes. You can catch the whole first season. Mm-hmm. Make them make more. I want a second series. It's so good.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Right on. All right. We're good?
Yeah, I think we're all happy paps. Yeah,
we're good. Yeah, music's already playing over this shit. Who cares what I'm fucking saying now? Pretty
good. Anything. Get Out's pretty good.
Yeah. We're going to get... We might get flack over Get Out. We missed something.
What did we miss?
I don't know.
I know we
missed... Someone's going to find out we missed something.
Picking the cotton to put it in his ears.
Oh my God. Yeah, we totally forgot about that.
Bye.
I felt bad about that.